All right, hello everyone, and peace of Christ to all of you. Today we tried to go early, but look like not many of you were aware that we will go live on air. So we schedule it again to be late at this time, which means it will be morning time for people in Asia. So good morning for those who are in Indonesia, Philippines, India, Singapore, Malaysia, wherever you are. And a good evening for those who they are in North America or South America. Let me introduce first a friend of mine who is really surprised about something. I mean, I don't know, like, you know, I'm trying to explain to him, but it's not working. I mean, I left for 5 hours, I came back, still he have the same look. I came back after 10 hours, still he have the same look. And I'm not sure what is the problem. I was maybe just thinking, maybe he is the same cat was jumping over the Quran. Do you remember the Muslims making video about the cat avoiding to walk over the Quran? Which is nothing but a fraud. You can bring the Quran and bring your cat. Not only she will jump in the top of it, she will do her business in the top of it. Today our topic is about the Quran. Chapter 5, verse number 116. Very interesting verse. You see, Muhammad, he did not tell us anything really about Jesus. And actually, even the name is, he got a guy, his name is Isa. We do not know who's Isa. But I'm guessing, and this is my own guessing, that Isa is a son of Maryam, who is the sister of Aaron. Maryam is a real woman. She is a sister of Aaron, as the Quran call her Maryam, quoting the exact name of the mother of Isa, which I believe that this is a son, Maryam, the sister of Aaron, the sister of Moses, had. So the confused Muhammad, he think that Isa is the nephew of Moses. Eh, makes sense. In front of us, we see this conversation supposedly happened between Allah and the guy whose name is Isa, between two brackets, Jesus. But you know, always, you know, when Muhammad, he speak about something, he come to us with the stories. Nobody, there's no witness for it. I mean, okay, who is the witness for this story? Nobody. Even Muhammad, he is not a witness. And remember when Allah says, okay, hold on, just to show you how stupid the author of the Quran. What do you mean remember? Like as if he was there. Like, hey brother, do you remember when Allah, he said to Isa, what remember what, where? This is the first time this story mentioned. Never mentioned in any book before. This story never ever mentioned before. So what demon do you remember? It's like going to somebody he never saw you before, say, do you remember me? He never met you before. Do you remember what? Like, hello? So, the Quran is a chain of idiot of the village talking. This verse, by itself, we can make a movie about it. So look how many mistakes we will count. And remember when Allah said, when Allah said, when is that? When? What do you mean when? When you see, when you say when, supposedly that should be a known time, known time, known date, known incident. When this happened, nobody knows. Okay, and look what it says, when Allah will say. Okay, hold on, Allah will say or Allah said? No, it says will say. This is the Muslim translation. Do you see it? So if Allah will say this sentence, that means this sentence never happened. Read carefully and please focus with me. Just I'm trying to show you how low the IQ of the author of the Quran. Remember, okay, if I remember, I have to remember something in the past. I mean, have you ever heard of somebody remember something for the future? Show me where it says the word remember in Arabic. You see, this is your Muslim translation, not my business. Okay, I will change translation for you. What translation you want? What translation you Muslims, you know, actually in Arabic, it's more horrible. It says, إِذَ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى. Qal is a past time, past sentence. But here we have إِذ. This is why the translator, he come to you, saying this is will happen in the future. So it's a wrong sentence. And just to make you happy, give me the name of the translator you like me to show you the translation, and I will do so. What translation do you Muslims accept? Name one for me, please. I'm looking at the chat. I mean, this is their translation, and yet they are saying to me, doesn't say that, CP. This is your translation. Who is the one who wrote this translation? I just see the name. Hold on. It doesn't say that, CP. It doesn't say that. Okay. Let us see the name of the translator. Muhammad Halili and Muhammad Khan. What do you want more? Okay, what translation you like? What is the translation you Muslims you like? You want Yusuf Ali? Shall we go with Yusuf Ali? Which one you want? Dudi Mududi? Biktal, Karari, Sarwar. I mean, look at the name. The name of them by themselves is crazy. Sahih International. Let us see Sahih International. It's called Sahih, so it must be Sahih. We change the translation. And be aware. Now he will complain. He says, show me where in Arabic it says be aware in that day. Okay. And be aware when Allah will say, okay, Allah will say, Allah will say this to Jesus. He will say to him, let us see the stupidity. Allah will say to Jesus, son of Mary, did you say to your people, take me and my mother as deities beside Allah? Okay, hold on. This is the question which Allah will say. But look, we have the answer. He will say, this is the Muslim translation. He will say, exalted are you. But look, this is a lie. Because in Arabic, it doesn't say that. It says, قَالَ سُبْحَانَكَ مَا يَكُونَ لِي. Allah in the past time, past, you know, so this is past tense. So they lie in every single translation. So this is the question in the future. In order to cover the bum of Muhammad, the one who made this verse, because it's full of mistakes. Because how you say he said, if this is a question, will happen in the future? You know what I mean? How you say that this is a question he will ask him in the future, and then here it says qala, which means he said. So look what happened here. In order to fix this issue, they say he will say, but it doesn't say that in the Quran. Change the translator. Hold on, this is Sahih International. Let us see Yusuf Ali. All right. And behold, Allah will say, O Jesus, son of Mary, didst thou say unto men, worship me and my mother as gods in derogation of Allah? He will say, It doesn't say that in Arabic. It says qala. He said. So in order to cover the disaster, you know what? I'm going to do this. In front of you, I'm going to use a stupid Google translation just to show you how stupid the whole story here. This is, we will open it in Google browser, and we will use Google translation. So we will see the Muslim translation in the right and Google translation in the left. Let us laugh. Translate to English. Look with me. Having said God, O Jesus, Son of Mary, have you said to people, it took me, take me and my mother as God beside Allah? Huh? And then he says, Jesus suppose says, what I have to say, what I don't have the right to say. I mean, this is the most stupid translation. We thought we were going to solve it. What is this? Google here is going crazy. I think because of the tashkil. Let us change the translation. Itani. This guy, he said he will say too, but it doesn't say in Arabic that he will say. Let us see a different one. We will see if one of them will be honest for a second. Oh boy. Look at this. Will say suddenly changed, became he said. Do you see it? Finally, we found somebody saying the truth. And when Allah, he said, O Jesus, Son of Mary, didst thou say unto men, take me and my mother as gods, apart from Allah? He said, finally, he said, okay, hold on. If this is something Allah will say to Jesus in the day of resurrection, how Jesus said already that? If this is a conversation that not happened yet, so how the Quran say that Jesus said? Any Muslim have an idea? The conversation did not happen. The conversation is going to happen in the day of judgment. And you know what? Let us open the interpretation for the verse so the Muhammadan they will not say this guy is making things up. You know them. You know them. It doesn't matter what the no ZB. It doesn't say that ZB. They will never deliver the baby. They are always in the 7 months. So if we go in the, let us see Ibn Kathir. Is Ibn Kathir is accepted? Who is Ibn Kathir, ZB? There's no imam. His name is Ibn Kathir, ZB. We never heard of him, ZB. All right. Let us see. This is Ibn Kathir. I will put him for you on the screen so we can read together and laugh together. This is what? This is Ibn Kathir. This is not me. Allah will also speak to his servant, the messenger Isa, son of Maryam, peace be upon him, saying to him, on the day of the resurrection, it's confirmed. Allah did not say this conversation yet. It's true. The Quran is a stupid book. So Allah will say to Isa in the day of resurrection, okay, how he will say that to Isa? And then Isa, he said, this, glory to be you, to you. It was not for me to say. But it says he said. In Arabic, in the Quran, it says he said. Read carefully. Abu Hurairah said then narrated that the Prophet said that Allah taught Isa to say. Allah taught Isa to say. So this is not the answer of Isa. Isa, come here, Isa, come here. Okay, I'm going to ask you this question. And I want you to repeat after me. When I ask you this question, you repeat this answer, okay? Okay, Allah. Now, I'm going to say to you, did you tell your people to worship you and your mother as God? When I say this question for you, you say the following. Glory to you, Allah. You know better. So Allah taught Isa what to say. What an investigation. Imagine you are going to be investigated by the FBI. And then the FBI, they ask you the question and they tell you the answer. Have you ever heard of a low IQ stupid story like this? And all of this to tell us that Jesus did not say worship me and my mother. You idiot. Where in Jesus he said worship me and my mother? Where Muhammad he got this stupid thing that the mother? Not a single Christian worship the mother of Jesus. Some fool, they might say to you, the Catholic. The Catholic don't worship Mary. The Catholic, they believe in the Trinity, the same as all the Christians, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Mary, she is a great woman, you know, respected by all churches. Nobody worship her. Nobody believe she is God. Nobody believe she is deity. So, this is a stupid statement. How this can be from God? And look what Isa, supposedly this answer guy, let's look, I mean, look at the drama. Isa, he says to him the question which Allah taught him. I mean, the answer, right? Okay, look at the answer. To thee glory be glory. It is not mine to say, not mine to say what I have no right to. If indeed I said though, you no know it. Isa saying to Allah, are you stupid or what? Aren't you God and you know everything? This is the truth. We have a Muslim saying, Catholic, they worship Jesus and Mary. You are a big fat liar like your prophet. Show me one Catholic book say such a statement. You are a potato like your prophet. Catholic are here, are laughing at you. So here you see the stupidity of the fabricator of the Quran. This is an answer supposedly taught by Allah. So Allah saying to himself, not Jesus, because this is his answer, was taught by who? By Allah. So what we can say according to this verse, that Allah was asking Allah, not Allah asking Isa, because who is the one who taught Isa the answer? Are you guys following with me? Who is the one who taught Isa the answer? Here we go, the proof in front of you. Abu Hurairah then narrated that the Prophet said that Allah taught Isa to say, glory to you, Allah, is not for me to say so. So Allah is asking Allah. Allah is not asking to Isa. Because the answer is the answer of Allah. Not that. Why Isa, he do not know what to say if Allah asking this question? Why this Isa is like one day old? Hey Isa, I will ask you this question, okay? When I ask you the question, this is mean day, you read this, okay? I want you to memorize it. Okay, Isa, memorize it, okay? Because I'm going to ask you this question in the judgment day. The second I ask you this question, you give me this answer, okay? This is a theater. This is a theater. That means this conversation is false, is fake. Because first, this is not the answer of Isa, as you see. That means Allah is asking Allah, and Allah is answering Allah. And how stupid Allah is to ask Allah. Because this is the question and the answer made by Allah, both of them. It doesn't have to be in a book, or no, it have to be in a book. Because if you cannot find one single line the Catholic says such a thing, it does mean you are a liar. It have to be in the book. Everything in the book, my friend. The Catholic believe in the four Gospels of Luke and Mark. I mean, it's just stupid. It doesn't have to be in the book. We are laughing at you. Actually, me myself, when I was a kid, I'm not a Catholic, but I did study for years in a Catholic school. So I know exactly what the Catholic teach very well. So when a Muslim, he say those stupid stories, I mean, we laugh. We just laugh. And here, look, they are trying to avoid the disaster of the stupidity. How this is can be from God? And then Allah, he taught Isa to say, if I say that, you should know it. Look at this idiot. Allah taught Isa to say to him, if I say that, you should know it. Be my witness. Oh boy. Somebody's asking me what domination you go. I believe in Jesus, my friend. I don't follow domination. What domination? Those are things, those are human beings, you know, schools. We follow the Christ, we follow the disciple. There's nothing, no such a thing. In Christianity, there's no such a thing. It's called Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox. This is man-made schools. It's okay, no problem. But the faith is clear. All of us, we believe. Doesn't matter what church you go to, as long as you believe in the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. You believe in the crucifixion, the resurrection. You believe that God is holy and the Messiah is his only begotten Son. You believe that he is coming back and his only Savior. You believe he is the Alpha and the Omega. You believe that everything was created by him and for him. You are a Christian. The rest is not is history. My friend, stop asking me to zoom out. Just open the page from your side. I gave you the page, I gave you the link, I gave you the number of the Quran. Open the website of Ibn Kathir and read it. How this is can be from God? Prince, may I debate you? My name is Fox, I am Protestant. Ronald, with my respect to you, you are a donkey. Because I am a Christian, I don't debate Christians. And you are not a Christian. Get lost. Can I debate you? Are you stupid or what? How I am a Christian and you want to debate me? Debate me about what? Are we going to debate about Mickey Mouse? If Mickey Mouse is real or cartoon? Get out of here. Don't get married, okay? Your wife, she will commit suicide second day. I want to debate you, Christian Prince. I'm Protestant. You are a Protestant. You are a Catholic. You are an Orthodox. It doesn't matter who you are. Obviously, you have a brain of a Lulu. Oh, boy. Who cares what is it, are you? Obviously, you're an idiot. Because a person who believes in Jesus, he should not follow a name of any man. All men are sinners. This is what the Bible says. All men, no priest, no bishop, no pope, no Catholic, no Protestant, no Orthodox, no Christian prince. All men are sinners. So the fool is the one who follow a sinner. Only fool. A true believer, he follow Christ. Follow no man. Those fool, They take a business of you. They divide you. That this is the business of the devil. You know, the Quran says something very truthful. In chapter 5, the same chapter we are reading from actually, verse number 114, Allah said in the Quran, I will spread hatred and enmity between the Christians. And those who make a fuss and a fight about Protestant and Catholic and Orthodox, they are serving the devil, which is Allah. And the proof is in front of you. Whoever call himself a priest, a bishop, whatever he call himself, he spread division between the Christians. He is serving the devil, Allah. No matter what is his name. There's only one person who will be happy to see the Christian divided. That is the devil, not Jesus. So why you are dividing the Christians? Because you are a servant of the devil. As simple as that, and the verse in the front of you. Now, we go back to our topic. How this is can be from God? You know, guys, I'm going to have a debate with Allah. Allah will give me the questions now, and the debate will happen in the judgment day. And Allah will give me the answers to answer it, so I will look like a fool. Why you would lie, believe that God have a human mother? That's the question, a good question, guys. A Muslim is using his brain, which is unique. My friend, don't tell your people your address. They will kidnap you, the Muslims. Because they will sell your brain for priceless money. I never saw one doing that before. Why would you believe God has a human mother? Okay, hold on. Why you Muslims believe that God, he can have a girlfriend in order to have a son? If God is capable of coming to this earth in any form he wants, who is going to stop him to be born? You? In the same time, you Muslims believe that Allah, he said in the Quran, if I wish to have a wife or a son, I'm going to take that wife or lahu from ourselves. How you can believe that God can have a girlfriend? And God, your God saying, if I want to take it, I will take it from ourself. I thought Allah is one. Is he one or two? Or he's a group or he's a tribe? Let us see. And then we find the Muslims explaining, saying that if Allah, he want to have a son, he is going to have a girlfriend from the virgins, the whore. The whore. The whore. Allah has, Allah is one and has no girlfriend. Okay, I will go with you. Allah, guys, when Allah, he made this verse, according to the Quran, he don't have a girlfriend. But look what it says. Had we intended to take a pastime, i.e. wife or a son, etc., etc. What does that mean, etc.? Is that a transgender or something? What is that, man? We could surely have taken it from us. Okay, who is us? Who is the Muslim you want to tell me? Allah want to take a wife from us. Does that mean Allah will have sex with himself? You see, when we say to the Muslims, well, Allah says us, he say we, they say this is majestic. God, he speak as king, like we, okay, okay. But here is talking about taking a wife. Allah will have a wife from us. Us who? I'm waiting for you, Jundullah. Who is a Muslim would not give me the answer. Allah will take a wife from us. Who is us? Hello? Let us call Zakir Naik and ask him about us. Tadadam, 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 tadadam. A Muslim don't answer unless it's trained three times, you know, Trinity. Christian Prince, I told you, don't call me. Zakir Naik, how you know it's me? You are the only one who called me at the time. And I told you I'm having sex with my wife. You are having what? Sex with my wife. You are having text with your wife? Sex with my wife. Oh, you having sex? You have sex with your wife. Sorry, because it's a... You're spitting all over. Anyway, Zakir Naik, I have a question here about Allah saying if you want to have a wife, he could have that wife from ourselves. So who is the wife of Allah from ourselves? Give me a breath. First of all, I'm not going to answer you because simply I'm a fit. Come on, Zakir Naik. You know what? I will make donation for you. You will make donation? I will make donation, absolutely. If you answer this question, Christian Prince, I don't want you to do anything. I know exactly what kind of donation you are going to make to me. You are going to send me your book. How you know I'm going to send you my book, man? Because I get one already. I bought it already. I do not want it. Okay, you got my book already. Which one? Sex and Allah? Yeah, that one. What do you understand? Hyperbole, a fugitive speech, or everything literal? Here we go. Suddenly now it is not literal. My friend, okay, I want you to explain to me. Forget about this is not literal. Guys, it's not literal. It's not literal. It is not literal. Okay, explain it to me. Allah will take it from ourselves. Explain it to us. Here we go. I'm listening. I'm going with you. I want you to explain to me when Allah, he says he will take a wife from ourself, what is that ourself? Or if he will take it from ourself. That means if it is, it's going to be from that kind. Explain to us, my friend. Let us say this is metaphorical. Guys, it's metaphorical. There's no dragon there. There's no dragon. Okay. So Allah will take a wife from ourself. What does that mean? Explain to me. I'm listening. Hello? Hello? This is metaphorical now. So wife is metaphorical? Guys, I'm going to get married from a metaphorical wife. What does that mean, my brother? Are you saying to me Allah will, like, he will marry a Barbie? What do you mean by metaphorical wife? And when Allah, he says us, he will take the wife from us, that metaphorical for what? His finger? This is majestic pearl? Okay, hold on, let me get you busted. Let us go to the interpretation of the verse and why we are wasting our time with those idiots who do not know how to read their book. A bunch of idiots in the text. In a second, everybody will laugh at you. And everybody will see that you are just a liar. Or one of two, either you are a liar or you are ignorant. I think you should choose ignorant better for you. Okay. Chapter 21, verse number 17. Let us see the interpretation made by the Muhammadan. Shall we? I mean, you can say now this is a Christian Prince's statement. It doesn't mean, it doesn't say that, CB. No, it says that. Here we go. This is, I will put it in the screen, your official Islamic website of the Kingdom of Jordan, Tafsir al-Jalalayn. It says, had we desired, some diversion, that which provide diversion in the way of a partner or a child. we would have found it with ourselves from among the beautiful eyed houris. Where is the metaphorical? Mr. Metaphorical, are you there? A brother and sister, let me introduce for you Dr. Metaphorical. Dr. Metaphorical, he is going to explain to you anything by saying it's metaphorical. Any question you give him, he said to you, rather you are metaphorical. How come your scholar did not say this is metaphorical? Hello? No, it doesn't say that, CP. Look, Allah saying he will take it from ourselves, and we find what? Those are the beautiful eyed houri, the one who have big mile ass, 1 mile. And now I understand why Allah, he made them 1 mile ass. Allah is big, is a kabir, akbar, is akbar. So obviously he's is big too. You know? What is the metaphorical? Mr. Metaphorical, are you there? Are you calling a friend? Hello? Let us take a commercial break, shall we? Because look like the Muslims are looking for answers. You know, and we need you know, give them time, because simply things is getting hot and complicated, and from metaphorical to metaphor problem, not metaphorical no more. You know what I'm talking about, brother? Commercial break. We are looking for metaphorical scholar. Tafsir al-Jalalain Metaphorical. Please, if you have a experience in the following field, call us immediately. Metaphorical Tafsir. Number 2, position. Metaphorical teacher. Number 3, decision. Mathematical teacher for metaphorical mathematics. Metaphorical Islamic brain. And metaphorical Allah. Thank you very much. End of the commercial. All right. What is the metaphorical? So it's hard for you to believe that Jesus, he have a mother, but it's okay for you to believe that Allah will have boom boom with the beautiful eyed houris? What the heck? I want to convert to Islam, brother. So now suddenly Allah, why you are scared to debate? Abu Hussein, I'm very scared, to be honest with you. I'm very scared to debate. Hey, Abu Hussein, do you want to debate me, my friend? Abu Hussein, do you like to debate me? I will not even call it a debate. I will call it metaphorical debate. Do you like to do metaphorical debate, Abu Hussein? Like, you know, you say metaphorical thing, I say metaphorical thing for you. Like we exchange metaphorical talk. What do you think, metaphorical Abu Hussein? Are you there, Abu Hussein? You know what, Abu Hussein? I think your Hussein is not real. I think he's metaphorical too. Because I think you are the same as your prophet. He imagined himself having sex, but in fact he did not, because it was metaphorical. Look! Even the prophet, his sex is metaphorical. You believe it, brother? The prophet, he don't have real sex. It is metaphorical. Yes, brother. Everything is metaphorical. Look, hold on. Let me show you with evidence, brother. I mean, what the heck with this guy? Even his sex was metaphorical. Look at this, brother. Metaphorical sex. I never heard of this before. The prophet continue. Who's talking? Aisha. Not me. So respect, please. Don't tell me this is metaphorical wife too. Don't tell me that this is metaphorical Aisha. Please. I mean, come on. too much metaphorical will kill you. The metaphorical Aisha, she said, the metaphorical prophet continued for such and such period of time, imagining that he had metaphorical sex. Do you see the hadith? Are you there? So how this guy is going to witness for Allah if he cannot even witness for his sex? His sex was false. Even his sex have no partner with it. There's no witnesses even for sex. The guy, he go to the bed, he do boom boom, but there's nobody there. Man, we don't know what he's doing. I mean, what do you think Muhammad was doing there? Metaphorical sex with who? This is a prophet of God. I'm really convinced that Muhammad is a prophet of God. His God is metaphorical God, and his wives are metaphorical wives, and the prophet, his sex is metaphorical sex, and now Allah is saying, if you want to have a wife, he will take it from ourself. And then we find that ourself is who? Is either the black-eyed houris or the angels. So Abu Hussein, do you want to call me so I open Skype for you? No, I'm not taking it out of context. Here we go. This is the Muslim translation. This is the Muslim website. This is the Muslim interpretation. This is the Sir al-Jalalain in front of your eyes. Nothing to do with me. Abu Hussein, still you want to call me, my friend, so I can open Skype just for you? People, they dream. My friend, he's not dreaming. You see, Abdul, the hadith says that the prophet was under black magic. He think he have sex. This is not a dream. He's awake. Oh, but hold on. You are saying to me that your prophet, he imagined himself having sex in the dream? In fact, he did not? No wonder he cannot have kids. This guy, he never did it. He was busy in the dream. Aisha, she want to sleep with him. But Muhammad always, he sleep with Aisha in the dream. He woke up in the morning, he say, Aisha, how you like it yesterday? According to you, according to your metaphorical story, which is not true. She said to him, what was good, what? He said, that's the last night. You remember what we did? Like the bingo stuff? Aisha said to him, are you crazy? You did not even get close to me. I was sleeping under the bed because you were farting. Abu Hussein call you? I mean, suppose like you are a very well-known person to call you. All that I need to go is just go to Skype and just make a call. And right away the call will call to you. Hilarious Muslims. Call me. let me find out. Your number is 0000 to 070s. So that's it. Just call me and I'm done. That's it, huh? I mean, that's it. Skype is made for you. You do not need to look for Abu Hussein. Just call any number you want. You will go to Abu Hussein. Abu Hussein is the cable connect conjunction. Hold on. I think Abu Hussein is the metaphorical Skype. What a bunch of potatoes. So if we go back to the topic, we will find that the Quran officially written by a fool. This conversation never happened. The answer for the conversation is not Isa answering, it's Allah, as the Muslim they claim. So what this conversation prove to us? You message me? Okay, hold on, Abu Hussein. Hold on, give me a second. Abu Hussein, you message me, guys. Just hold on. What happened here? All right, Abu Hussein, I'm logging in Skype and I will check. All right, Abu Hussein. Let us call Mr. Abu Hussein.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
You were talking about the black magic.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, what about it?
So, hold on. So, with regard to him imagining that he'd done something, that does not like impact his truthfulness because of the evidence to that effect and the scholarly consensus that he was protected from that.
He was protected? How is he protected?
Because Allah protected him.
Okay, so...
So rather, it was one of the matters of this world.
All right.
Which are not the reason for which he was sent, and which are not the basis of his virtue, and in which he was like all other human beings. So it is not far-fetched to say that he might imagine something that were not real.
All right.
Then things became clear to him later on, as indeed happened.
Okay. So, first of all, let me welcome you, Abu Hussein. Sound like you're a very nice person. Sorry, I took you wrong in the text. I was maybe a little bit harsh with you, but look like you're a nice person. So you are welcome in to talk to us. So I want to make it clear. Are you saying that the Prophet, he protected, so he never made something wrong regarding Islam, like teaching or ordering?
Yes.
Okay. Do you know, do you speak Arabic?
Mkassar.
Okay. Mkassar, mkassar. Mjabburha. Let us see what the Quran says. Did Muhammad order anything which is not lawful for him to do, ever?
What does that mean?
Like, you know, he forbid something, it's not lawful for him to forbid?
I'm not sure what you're talking
Because about. You said that he is a protected, so he will not do something against the teaching of Allah, correct?
Yeah.
All right. Have you ever heard of a chapter, it's called At-Tahrim?
Yes.
Okay. What the first verse in that chapter, do you know?
At-Tahrim is Surah 66 or...
Exactly. Chapter 66. Correct. Chapter 66, oh. Allah supposedly saying to Muhammad, why you forbid something which Allah didn't make it lawful for you, which means this is against the teaching of Allah.
Yeah.
But you just said that the Prophet, when it's come to teaching about Islam and practicing the teaching of Allah, he would never break the Allah teaching.
No, he didn't. He didn't prohibit him in the beginning.
No, it says here, it says, why you are forbidding yourself from doing something? Allah made it lawful for you. Why? He's questioning. Why? You see, when you say why about what? Allah, he made it lawful for you. Look, read with me. It says, Allah, which Allah has made in the past, right? Made?
Yeah.
Okay. So, he made for you. So, already...
So Allah, Allah gave us permission to eat, like, many different types of fruit. But if I don't like to eat, like, apples, does that mean that I'm sinning if I don't eat apples?
So why Allah is... Okay, so are you saying to me, I mean, don't you think this is silly that Allah is talking to Muhammad, saying to him, why you are saying you will not like eat apple? This is the whole thought. Allah in the seven galaxies. I mean, what a big deal. I don't like to eat zucchini. Here we go. So Allah will make a verse to Christian Prince, saying to him, Christian Prince, why you are forbidding zucchini for yourself when I made it lawful for you? What, the guy don't like it? So there's no way this is about apple and food. This is about your prophet having sex with a woman. Her name is Mary the cook. She is his servant. Is that correct?
What?
This is about a woman. Her name is Mary the cook. She is a slave of Muhammad. He was sleeping with her in the bed of his wife, Hafsa.
So Al-Bukhari and Muslim, they narrated from Aisha that the Prophet used to stay with Zainab bin Jahash and drink honey in her house. She said, so Hafsa and I agreed that whichever of us the Prophet entered upon would say, I can smell a maghafir, a type of gum that has an unpleasant odor on you. Have you eaten maghafir? He entered upon one of them, and she said that to them. He said, no, I drank honey at the house of Zainab and Jahash, but I will never do it again. So then this is, the following verses was revealed. Why do you forbid yourself that which Allah has allowed to you?
Okay, you know, I will go with you, but the scholars don't agree with this. The scholars, they say that this is about Muhammad sleeping with the woman. Her name is Mary the Copt, and his wife Hafsa, she found him sleeping in the bed with her. And here we go. This is Tafsir al-Jalalain, just to show you I'm not making things my own. This is the story. This is Tafsir al-Jalalain. It says, O Prophet, why do you forbid what God has made lawful for you in terms of your Coptic handmaid, Maria, when he lay with her in the house of Hafsa, who had been away, but who, upon entering and finding out, become upset? So look what happened. Muhammad is sleeping with, he's doing boom boom with Mary the Copt. Hafsa, she opened the door. She find Muhammad in the bed. Who's saying that? Your scholars.
Yeah, so that is one interpretation.
Okay, so it doesn't matter, my friend. Obviously, here we have a problem. First of all, if it is honey or apple or chocolate or about sex, if Muhammad forbids something, it's not for him to forbid. That means he broke the order of Allah. And this is what Allah, he said in the Quran.
That's not breaking the order.
So why Allah is saying to him, why you forbid something? Obviously, he broke it.
Because he said that he will never eat honey again.
Exactly so, but it's not right. Is it right or not right? Is it right or not right to say, I should not eat honey, according to you? Is it okay to say that?
It's the man's choice.
Okay, so why Allah saying it's not right then?
No, he's asking why the Prophet, peace be upon him, like, why did he forbid it for himself? That's just a question. He's not saying he did something wrong.
No, your Prophet, right away he broke his oath, the one who made to his wife, and he started doing what he was doing before. So your Prophet, he made this verse, actually, so he can go back and sleep with Mary the Copt. So he make an oath saying, I swear by Allah, I will never do that again, like as you said. And then he made this verse because he missed this woman, he wanted to sleep with her. So he made a verse so he can break his promise. Say, Allah told me why you are forbidding this. Let me ask you, did your Prophet sleep with Mary the Copt?
Mary the Copt, I'm not sure.
What do you mean not sure?
Maybe I don't know.
Well, all Islamic books confirm. Here we go in front of you. Not only that, he is sleeping with her in the bed of his wife, and she is a handmaid. He never married her. So here we need to ask ourselves: where Allah He made it lawful for Muhammad to sleep with his handmaid? Nowhere. Show me a verse in the Quran. It says to Muslims, "You can sleep with your handmaid." Can you show me a verse?
You can sleep with your handmaiden.
Yeah, she is a handmaid.
Yeah, in chapter 424.
This is about a right-hand process from the war.
Yeah,
Malakatul Yameen is from the war. Mary the Copt, she is a gift given to Muhammad from the king or the ruler of Egypt. So
yeah,
she is not.
He married her.
No, he never married her. No, he never married her. It's a big fat lie. No Muslim count Mary the Copt as one of his wives. Never.
Are you sure?
Oh yeah, I'm very sure.
So she was one of the Prophet's concubines.
Okay, but who made it made her lawful for him to sleep with her? As you see, the Quran says you can sleep with women who they are right-hand possessed from war. Okay.
Yeah, so the Prophet...
Okay, so how Muhammad, he got the... Where it is made lawful for him to sleep with a slave who is not slave of war? Never.
Prophet's culture. The prophet had four concubines, and one of whom was Maria.
Thank you. So she's his wife. So now, where in the Quran it says for him it's lawful for you to have sex with a slave? She is slave from, like, not from war. Nowhere.
Yeah, that it says,
Where?
and prohibited to you all married women except those your right hands possess.
Exactly, right hand possess is a slaves from war. Malikatul Yameen is women from war, not from
Yeah,
buying them in the market.
it's also talking about the handmaidens.
No, my friend. Okay, show me where in which Islamic interpretation says that this is Malikatul Yameen. It is about women who they are slaves, not from war.
I just show like that's what it means. Like
Okay, I'm asking you where, who is the scholar? He said that Malikatul Yameen is not about, the right hand possess is not about women who they are from war. Nowhere. And all Muslim scholars agree that Mary, she was just a slave, was given to him as a gift. So he have no right to sleep with her. She is not from war.
Surah Al-Ahzab 33, verse 6.
Al-Ahzab 33, verse number 6. Okay, what about it?
The prophet is closer to the believers than their own selves, and his wives are their believers' mothers.
What does this mean? What does this have to do with our topic? Mary the Copt, she is not his wife anyway. What does this have to do with our topic?
So you want to find a verse. Like if the prophet did it, then
My friend, my friend.
automatically
If
it's
Allah,
good.
he made it lawful for him, that means it was made lawful for him. If he did not, then Muhammad is a fornicator. As
No,
simple as
no,
that.
no, no.
Okay, so show me where Allah, he made it lawful for him to sleep with a slave. She is not a slave of war.
I just showed you
Where?
if the prophet did it, that means it's allowed.
Oh, so the prophet, he do whatever he want, but Allah is asking him, why you do that?
No, yeah, he's asking him why he did it. It doesn't mean that it's wrong.
Okay, he's asking him why you forbid it. I made it lawful for you, but where is where he? Because you see, he made it lawful for you. That's mean he said that to him before. I'm not going to question you about why you are forbidding something I made lawful for you unless I made it already lawful for you. So can you show me the verse where it says it's made lawful for him? Nowhere. And you know what? Let us not to argue too much about this one because you can stay there as much as you wish. You said that your prophet is protected when it's come to teaching. Did your prophet receive
Yeah.
satanic verses?
No.
No. So the Quran is lying, isn't it? The Quran says that Allah will delete whatever shaitan he throw in the mouth of Muhammad.
So even if, like, for argument's sake, this is true, the scholars they said that he understood it as meaning that the shaitan caused the kuffar to hear the words,
Not
not that
true.
he put them in the mouth of the prophet,
Not
so they heard them from him.
true. Here we go. This is chapter 22, verse number 52, and this is the website is open in front of your eyes. I will go there, and we will see, you know, what the verse is saying. Chapter 22, Al-Hajj, verse number 52. Let us see what your Islamic scholar says. You see, Muslim scholars, they are trying to defend your prophet as much as they can. But obviously,
Can you read the next verse?
no problem. I will read the 10 verses after it, no problem. But let's see the meaning of this verse before we continue. And you see, I'm not making the mean me myself. I'm going to read for you what your scholar says. Okay. This is Tafsir al-Jalalain. Read with me carefully. It says here, but when he recited the scripture, Satan cast into his recitation.
Yeah, so
Okay.
there's no sahih isnad from the Prophet, peace be upon him, concerning this report.
My friend, the Quran is not sahih. The Quran confirmed, hold on, the Quran confirmed that your prophet, he receives satanic verses, Allah will delete it. You see, it says, okay, it says, Alqa shaytanu fi umniyate. Alqa shaytanu fi, where, he, shaytan, where, alqa, where, umniyate, umniyate, who, Muhammad, not the people. Okay,
but read what it says. But read what it says.
I'm reading.
It says that, but it says that Allah removes.
Thank you very much. So you said to me that Allah protect Muhammad from Shaitan, so
yeah,
he will not
by removing.
Okay, by so it's too late. Look, after I got shot, you are protecting me now.
This is not a bullet. What are you talking about?
It doesn't matter. It's worse than a bullet. He just worshipped Shaitan. He just worshipped the three. He worshipped the three daughters of Allah. Read.
This story is not.
Listen, Abu Hazay. Read. But that when he recited the scripture, Shaitan cast into his recitation what is not from the Quran, but which those whom he, the prophet, and has been sent to find the, pleasing. The prophet had during the assembly of men of Quraysh, after reciting the following verse from Surah Al-Najm, have you considered Al-Lat Al-Uzza and Manat, the third one? And then he said he added as a result.
You can read Ibn Kathir's refutation of this in Tafsir of Surah Al-Hajj.
Okay, I wanna take your promise. If we go to Ibn Kathir, we'll accept what Ibn Kathir he say.
Ibn Kathir refutes this.
All right, let us go and see what Ibn Kathir says. Is it okay? Ibn Kathir in English is far away from Ibn Kathir in Arabic. So I'm going to open Ibn Kathir in Arabic. Is that okay? You speak Arabic, you should be broken, but it's okay. You understand, right?
I understand very little.
All right. Very little. Okay, do you have somebody next to you speak Arabic? Because I can open now Ibn Kathir, and you will see Ibn Kathir cannot refute that. You see, Ibn Kathir, first of all, he came more than 800 years after Muhammad. Correct? How somebody came in 800 years after Muhammad refute what happened? I mean, this is silly. It's like you now. It's like you saying, you came 1400 years after Muhammad and you refuted this. This is funny. This is silly.
Okay. So you take the story from where? From Jalalain.
Okay.
Jalalain came how many years after
Muhammad? No, I'm not taking from the Jalalain. The Quran saying it clearly. Allah will take it off. Allah will take it off. So the Quran, he put it there. Where in the Quran? Allah will take it from where? From the Quran, correct?
Astaghfirullah.
Okay, astaghfirullah. Okay. Listen, my friend, Allah will take the satanic verses from where? From the Quran or from the earlier pages? I want an answer, please.
When it says when Allah, when Shaitan, he throws into the mouth of the Prophet, Allah removes what Allah...
Okay, remove it from where? From where?
From the recitation.
Okay, what is recitation? Isn't the Quran is a recitation?
Okay, yeah.
Okay, thank you. So Allah remove from the recitation, which is the Quran, the satanic verses. So he is not protected because Shaitan already, it's already Shaitan. Okay, the verses, those verses coming from here, from Shaitan. So at that moment when your prophet was reciting, he was reciting what? The word of Shaitan. So Muhammad was a messenger of Shaitan.
No, it does not say he recited it. He said,
What do you mean? Hold on. Verse. Okay, hold on. It says, He did recite. Hold on. Listen. Okay. Read the one after it. لِيَجْعَلُ الشَّيْطَانَ مَا يُلْقِي الشَّيْطَانَ فِتْنَةً. So Allah, Shaitan, he will cause what he throw as a trial. Okay. He throw where? You agreed that this is in the tongue of the Prophet. Thank you very much. So Shaitan, he throw that to cause a problem. No problem. That's wonderful because he's Shaitan anyway. I mean, what do you expect Shaitan to say to do something good? No way. But what happened now that your prophet, when he recited the words of Shaitan, he became a messenger of Shaitan.
Okay, so it says that Allah make what Shaitan is thrown, a trial for those whose hearts is a disease.
Okay.
So, as I said before, its meaning is that the shaitan causes the kuffar to hear these words, not that he put them in the mouth of the prophet, peace be upon him, so that they heard from him.
My friend, but what happened, it's not the kuffar who got hurt, it was Muhammad. Because as you see, this has caused trouble to Muhammad. This is very funny explanation. Because the kuffar, anyway, they don't believe in Muhammad. They don't follow Muhammad. This is funny. The one who was hurt by this statement is Muhammad and Islam, not the kuffar. This is why they are laughing at him. And now me and you, we are talking about this because Muhammad is hurt by this, not the kuffar. This is funny argument. The one who, the shaitan, he did not throw.
He was not affected. The ears of the kuffar were affected.
No, my friend, the hadith says that he, Muhammad, and the kuffar, and the believer, they bow down together. Is that true or not?
That he and who?
The kuffar and the believers and Muhammad, yes, they bow down,
yes,
together.
Yes,
okay.
Yes,
so
yes.
All of them, they worship what? The Lat al-Uzza. But because Muhammad saying the Lat al-Uzza, how the Muslims, they bow down. So that hurt the Muslims too, because Muhammad, he made the Muslims bow down.
No. To the Muslims, he was talking about Allah. And the kuffar, If we assume that the satanic verses are true, but which they are not, if it's true, they heard that about the Alat al-Uzan and Manat.
Okay, let me ask you. So, you are saying that the Quran is a lie? Because you just said if the story of al-Gharaniq is true, but isn't it the Quran saying Allah will take it off? So Allah will take off something that never happened?
No. It happened like for a split second, and he removed it right away.
Thank you very much, guys. We just heard it from Abu Hussein that it happened for a split of second. Muhammad became a messenger of the shaitan, speaking for shaitan. It doesn't matter, a second, 2 seconds.
I didn't say he spoke.
No, you did. You did. You said it happened for a split. No, and you said everybody heard you. It's recorded. It's you said he put it in his recitation. You agreed. Come on, you are a man. Don't take it. Don't swallow your words. You said 10 minutes ago that yes, shaitan, he put it in the recitation. Thank you. Recitation, I said to you, and as you remember, I said to you, isn't it recitation Quran? You said yes. And then you said, okay, that's fine. So now he put it in the recitation, which is in the mouth of Muhammad, which means Muhammad reciting the shaitan words and Allah words in the same time. And that make it mixed together. So shaitan is mixing Quran with his own word. And now, how we can guarantee that this verse in the front of you is not from shaitan?
This verse?
Yeah, because shaitan, he want to make you relax. Here we go. He got Muhammad saying his words, and now people, they know that this is going to be true. This is wrong. So Allah, shaitan, he made this verse to Muhammad saying, okay, well, you know what? Whatever shaitan he put in there, I will take it off. Don't worry.
No. If shaitan wrote this verse, then he would tell people to go steal. He would tell people to go rape. He would tell people to go
isn't it the Quran teach you to rape and to kill and to steal? Isn't it the Muslim accuse your prophet that he stole an underwear?
Stole what?
An underwear.
What are you talking about?
The Quran, chapter 3, verse 161, they are fighting over stolen goods. And you are saying to me, the Quran, if this is from shaitan, the shaitan should teach them to steal. Here we go. The Muslims, they are fighting with their prophet, saying that he illegally stole from the booty. So now we have the Pirate of the Caribbean fighting over a piece of clothing, accusing their prophet that he is a thief, he stole it from the theft. And you just said, if this book from shaitan, then you will find the Quran teaching you to steal. But the Quran make it legal to steal, as long as you are stealing from non-Muslims.
Okay. Show me where it says.
Chapter 3, chapter 3, verse 161. Let us see. You see, because you might say I'm making things up. I like to show the proof. So you don't say I'm making things up. You know, here we go. Let me show it to you on the screen. I don't say things from my own. Here we go. This is Tafsir al-Jalalain in front of you. This is
from a Tafsir. So the Quran doesn't say that.
Okay, no, the Quran says, وَمَا كَانَ لِنَبِيٍ أَن يَغُلْ. It's not for a prophet to be a thief. Why Allah saying that? Who is the one accusing him to be a thief? Tell me. Can you tell me? It's the Muslims. Read it. When some red velvet cloth went missing in the day of Badr, and some people began to say, perhaps the Prophet took it. The following verse, or following, was revealed.
Wait,
it is not for a prophet to be a fraud. They accuse him to be a fraud. The Muslims who believe
red
in Muhammad,
velvet cloth.
The Muslims, the
or where
Muhammadan,
does it say underwear?
It's not underwear. It's what? You tell me. It's a. Is it a? Is it a bra?
What?
I'm asking you. You tell me. Okay. It's
why
a piece. It's a piece of red cloth. It's who is the man who wanna wear red clothes? Those are Arab. So it's a piece of red velvet clothes. Okay. So what is that? Is it underwear of women?
It doesn't say
Arab men wear red clothing? Are you saying to me your prophet was Santa Claus? I'm just asking you. So obviously it's an underwear, maybe a bikini, we do not know. Maybe a swimming suit, I don't know. You tell me. But what we care for, your followers, they are laughing at your prophet, saying to him, you are a fraud, read it. Abu Hussein is dying laughing. I made Muslims laugh at their prophet. What do you want more? Okay, so what do you say now?
Okay, this is obviously fake.
Obviously fake? This is Jalalain. Jalalain is fake?
When someone... Yeah, it doesn't say underwear. What
do
you
think? Okay. So. It doesn't say, the problem is the underwear now. It doesn't say underwear. Okay, maybe it's a pant, not underwear, you think? Maybe it's a bra. Maybe it was a short, maybe. Maybe it's a pajama. You know? Yeah. So, you Muslims accusing your prophet to be a fraud and to be a thief. What kind of religion? If those are the companion of Muhammad, accusing their best man to be a fraud and to be a thief. So what about the rest? This is the best man.
Day of Badr. Yeah, I don't know about this.
You do not know about this. Okay, you know what? I'm not going to ask you questions no more. I want you to help me. You see, there's like 800 people listening. I want you to tell us how you can prove to us that Muhammad is a prophet. You know, when we say somebody's a prophet, shouldn't he have a prophecy?
Prophecy?
Yeah. I mean, you call a person
a
prophet,
like
he should be...
The prophet had many prophecies.
Like what? Like what?
I can show you some of them.
Give me one.
I can show you.
By the way, I mean, if the prophet was accused that he stole an underwear, shouldn't Allah tell us who took it? Well, I mean, what kind of a prophet he cannot prophesy who is the one who took the underwear? Here we go, they are accusing him that he took a piece of a cloth. So shouldn't the prophet prophesy who took it? He go to home, he listened to Allah. Allah inspire him, he says to him, go to the house of a Christian prince, open the closet. Go behind the closet and you will find a box. You open the box, inside the box there's a box. And then you open the box, inside the box there's another box. And then you open the box, inside the box, inside the box, inside the box. And then you will find the red underwear. And that will make Muhammad a prophet. But look, they accuse him to be a thief, stealing underwear. He could not prophesy who took it. Or what he came.
It doesn't. You don't have to be that dishonest and say it's underwear.
My friend, it is a piece of a cloth. It is red. You tell me why you Muslim. You don't tell us what it is then. Why you cannot be honest? Why you Muslim? No. Why you Muslims cannot be honest and tell us what it is?
What does it say in Arabic?
Qatifa.
Okay.
Piece of a clothing.
Okay.
So why you don't tell us what it is? Why you don't tell us it's not an? Tell us it's a pant. Tell us it's a jacket. Why you don't say what it is? So all what we know
like
now.
A scarf. Well, why not a scarf?
At that time there is no underwear anyway. So obviously Aisha, she used to. You said a scarf, right? Everybody, did you hear it? He said a scarf. Thank you very much. That's an underwear. According to the hadith, Aisha, she said that the prophet used to order me to put a sheet between my legs, and he fondled me. That is their underwear. Okay,
What are you talking about, man?
hold on. Let me show you. Okay, brother, let me show you. Okay, here we go. You are the one who came with the word scarf, not me. It's your mistake, not mis my mistake. What are you talking about? You are talking to Christian Prince. Get ready. Here we go. Do you see it? I warp myself, and here in the translation they say Izar. So when she is in her ministration, look how nice your prophet, man, how decent he is. The woman, she is a bleeding, and he is not caring. And he is ordering his wife to put a sheet around her private part so he can fondle her. Does it say that, or I'm making things out? Making things
Oh,
up.
which one?
And here it says agreed upon. In Arabic, it says agreed upon. Do you see it? So you can say it's not accepted. Sahih, Rawahu al-Bukhari, Hadith number 300, and in Muslim, Hadith number 293, and agreed upon. Muttafaqun alayh. Okay? So this is agreed upon, and the Prophet, he used to fondle his wife while she have menstruation by ordering her to put an izar, a sheet around a scarf around her private part. So why you are saying
Okay,
it's not under?
that's very clean. That's a very clean way of doing it.
It's a clean. The woman, she have
Yeah.
menstruation. How is that a clean? Explain to us. Actually, you know what, Abu Hussein, I'm very naive. You know, I'm single. I did not understand what's happening here. Can you explain to us what exactly your prophet did?
What?
Can you explain to us what your prophet did? Because I am single. I do not know what those things is. I do not know what menstruation mean. I don't know. So what your prophet was doing there, if you can explain to us.
So, this is just reporting what the prophet had done with his wife.
Yeah, what he
Like
did.
in the Book of Solomon, you see that Solomon had sex with his wife, and then you see that the Bible
In
talks
the Book
about
of
her
Solomon, it says he
boobs.
ordered his wife to put a sheet between her legs. So,
So this is the
so
izar. So
my
like
friend, okay, I'm asking
izar is
you. I'm asking you. Okay, I'm asking you to
like a
explain to me.
garment
Okay, I'm asking
that
you.
covers the like the body.
Okay, I'm asking you what she did exactly, and what your prophet was doing here.
So he would it's not my business to talk about what he did
Okay, if
and
it's
the
well,
women did, but
you are not a Muslim? Are you saying you are not a
it's
Muslim?
no. I'm saying it's not my business to talk about what the prophet did in his sexual life.
Why? So why the prophet wife, she is telling us what happened in his sexual life, is if this is none of your Muslim's business.
Yeah, so
Why she is talking?
this is talking about during menstruation.
I understand, but what he was doing, why you are trying to avoid talking of, this is a guy who claimed to be a prophet. And let me ask you, are you allowed as a Muslim to have sex with your wife when she have menstruation?
This hadith says yes, so yeah.
Okay, but isn't it, this is according to, you see, guys, did he say yeah? Yeah, okay. You said that the prophet never broke the teaching of Allah. The Quran says, no, just you said yes, you said everybody heard
No,
you.
I meant
The Abu
no.
Hussein, I got you busted.
When I
So,
was menstruating, this is talking about. So when I was menstruating, and then he did this after she finished menstruating.
No, she said, I am, here we go. Let's read the hadith again.
So this is a
I
fiqh hadith.
was menstruating. I was menstruating, not after. Read it. And here we go in Arabic. Wa ana ha'id. And I am administrating exactly as a translation. So please don't play games. And now, because I said to you, the Quran say that you cannot do that, you are trying to swallow your words. Look what the Quran said. The Quran get your prophet busted. He is hypocrite. The Quran says that when women, they have menstruation, stay away from them. Chapter 22, verse, no, chapter, sorry, chapter 2, verse 222, and chapter, yeah, this verse is enough. Here we go. It says, therefore, keep away from women during menses. Does it say that?
Yeah, you can't have sexual intercourse.
Okay. When, so your prophet, what your prophet was doing? Okay, so what your prophet was fondling her when she is having her menstruation. The Quran says,
oh, there we go. It says fondle. It doesn't say sexual intercourse.
So what fondle? Explain to me. I'm naive. What fondle mean?
Touch.
Ah. But he is ordering her to put an izar between her legs.
Okay. Yeah, okay. How can you have sexual intercourse?
Okay, hold on.
There's an izar between your legs.
Okay, hold on. Guys, he is saying he did not have intercourse, but he was playing between her, with his private part. That is not sex in Islam. So what is sex in Islam then?
Sexual intercourse in Islam is
Look what the Quran says. It says, so keep away from them. Keep away. Did not even mention anything about sexual. Keep away from them. Stay away from them. Why your prophet is not staying away? You just said, according, everybody heard you, he was playing with her, touching her, playing here, there, fingers, nose, tongue, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Okay? So now your prophet is breaking the Quran, because the Quran says when they have their menses, stay away from them.
Yeah, so when it says keep away from them, it means don't have sex with them.
Okay. You see, I want to play the game that you played with me. You said to me where it says underwear. Can you show me where it says don't have sex with them?
Yeah.
Where?
I showed you.
Where? The Quran doesn't say that. The Quran says, stay away from them. La taqrabuhunna.
In Surah Baqarah, ayah 222.
Well, this is the verse we're reading from. Here we go. It doesn't say what you're saying. My friend, read. It says, wala taqrabuhunna. Don't get close to them. Don't get close. Nowhere it says sex. Don't get close to them. Simple.
Say that an adha, a harmful thing for a husband to have a sexual intercourse with his wife while she is having her menses. Therefore, keep away from women during menses.
My friend, nowhere in the verse it says sexual intercourse, not even once. And I challenge you. Here we go. I have the verse in front of you in Arabic. Can you show me which word is the word sexual intercourse? Nowhere.
Well, the Torah says that.
No, don't. You see, Muhammad is trying to copy the Jews, right? So I'm asking you now. Where in the verse says don't have sexual intercourse?
Yeah, so when it says keep away, it means you can't have sex with them.
Okay, you cannot get close to them too. It says wala taqrabuhun, don't get close to them. Let me ask you, did your prophet say that women and shit, excuse my language, are the one who break your preparation for a prayer?
Women and what?
Women and shit.
And women and shit?
Yeah. So how this woman, she have menstruation and your prophet touching her and now he is going to pray and she have menstruation. If the Quran said that women and poop, you know, both they break your, preparation for a prayer, your prayer will not be accepted.
So it doesn't say that the prophet had sexual intercourse with her. it said that he just touched her. And then in this verse, it when it says keep away from them, it means don't have sex with them.
Okay, so anything you have to do with sex, you don't have sex with them. So you just say your prophet was playing with her. Isn't it fondling? You see, in Arabic it says yubashir. Yubashir is you starting sex. This is what yubashir means. You want me to show you the proof? I just can type the word yubashir in hadith and you will see it all over. It is a starting sex, whatever it is. Now read here with me. In chapter 5, verse number 6, it says that if you go, if you are in, like, you know, when you are a Muslim, you want to pray, all right? You have to wash, etc., blah, 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 okay? And then it says, and if one of them is sick or he was in trouble, in a journey, and any of you comes from doing poo-poo or touch women, does it say that?
What ayah is this?
Chapter 5, verse 6.
So Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, said, according to a report narrated by her, whoever told you that Muhammad concealed anything that he was instructed to convey has told the gravest lies against Allah. She then recited the verse mentioned. It says, and remember when you said to him, Zayd bin Harith, on whom Allah bestowed grace, have done it. So he says, keep your wife to yourself.
What are you reading now? Why are you reading that verse? I asked you to read chapter 5, verse number 6, where it says that if you touch women and poop, your prayer is not accepted no more. Your prophet is not only touching women, he is touching a woman she had menstruation. And the Quran says to him, stay away from women. So the Quran consider women are dirty, same as poop. And here you will see that women who have menstruation, your prophet is doing what he is doing with her.
Yeah, okay. So it says right here that you said 5 for 6?
What?
So if you are defiled, purify, wash yourselves. But if you are sick with an illness made worse by water or on a journey traveling, or if any of you comes from the privy, that is, if he has defecated, or if you have touched a woman, as mentioned already in the verse Surah An-Nisa.
So if you touch a woman, what touch a woman mean? Does that mean sex?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Guys, you just say to me in the hadith that the Prophet was touching her. And you confirm that the word touch means sex.
No, in this verse it says like if you can't have sex.
Hold on, the word here, I just ask you, the word there in the Quran appear is touched. Doesn't say the word sex. I ask you, is it mean that when the Quran says the word touch them means sex? You said yes. Well, this is what the hadith is saying according to you. You said he was touching her. So touch means sex?
He did not have sexual intercourse.
But you just say that touch means sex, and here the word is touch too.
Can you explain what this is talking about? It says,
my friend, says, you cannot explain, you are in trouble. Okay, you know what? Forget about all of this. Abu Hasan, everybody,
wash your faces and hands up to the elbows, that is, including them, and the elbows, as clarified in the Sunnah, and wipe your heads.
Okay, why you wash your hand to the elbow?
So, yeah, it's talking about the prayer. So how do you know that the Prophet So he had to perform wudu before he did the prayer.
Okay, let me ask you. When was your prophet a clean person?
Yeah.
Okay, do you think a clean person he will do you, okay,
cleanliness
do you think a
is
clean
like the highest standard in
okay, we will
Islam.
see that. Okay, guys, the prophet he have highest standard of cleanliness. Okay, let me ask, so do you think a clean person he will do any kind of sexual activities with a woman she have her menstruation? Is that a cleaning for you? I mean, the woman, she hate herself now. She have her menstruation. And on top of that, now she have to satisfy a guy who is horny. Is that how a clean man he act?
Okay, so there's nothing wrong. It's actually like he didn't have sexual intercourse with her, as I said. He just touched her.
Abu Hussein, you know, I'm scratching my head now. Actually, I have some lice. Do you think if I have a lice, that's make me dirty? If I have a lice?
You have lice on your head?
Not many, it's few.
Maybe because you keep sitting behind the screen and you don't show your face.
So what do you think? Is that make me dirty if I have lice?
Ask yourself that.
No, I'm asking you. I mean, is lice because somebody he's taking a shower or because he's filthy or he's dirty or clean? What do you think? Be honest, it's okay. You can hurt my feeling, no problem. I have a glue, I will fix it.
You're like. It's probably gonna be a trap.
It's what?
It's probably a trap. You're trapping me.
It's a trap. It's a trap. Yeah, there's an article written by Muslims about debating Christian prince. In the article, they say if a Christian prince said something good about the prophet, don't say yes because it's a trap. If he something bad, don't say no because it's a trap. So it doesn't matter what I say, he will say it's a trap. So what is the point of the conversation? You have to tell me. I have some lice in my head. Do you think I am dirty?
If you have lice, yeah, sure, you're dirty.
Thank you very much. So if I show you now that your prophet, he have a lot of lice in his head, what you would do?
Well, if they lived in the desert, then that's very common because like they're outside and. But if for you, if you have lice and you're in your house, that would mean that you're extra dirty.
Well, you just say that the one who have lice obviously he is dirty. So at that time, it doesn't matter what he is. That time, that this time, he is dirty still. Thank you very much. So you're a prophet here. Here we go. He go and sit in the lap of a woman, and she is taking lice from his hair. And this is a Sahih Hadith. Are you allowed as a Muslim to take shower in dirty water, Abu Hussein?
In dirty water?
Yeah.
No.
What about ablution for a prayer?
Yeah, no, it has to be clean water. But
So
if there's no
you
other
cannot,
water
okay,
and they have this water,
what if
then
okay, I want to tell you a story. If a guy he is walking down the street and he want to do ablution, and he saw a place have a dead dog in the water, a small tiny container of water. There's dead dog, there's women blood from period, there's garbage, and he did ablution. Is his prayer is accepted?
If there was no other water,
Yeah.
it's all about in Islam. It's all about intention. So if his intention was to do good, then Allah
No,
would
but there is other
reward
water.
him.
He live in a town. There is other water. He is not in the desert. He is in his home. So there's a little tiny place in the town, which all people throw garbage. Is that okay? There's water. There's people. They water drink from it. You know, he's in town. He's not in traveling from place to place. Is that okay?
I feel like this is a trap again.
It's a trap, for sure. It's a trap. I mean, you're a prophet. He takes shower with dead dogs. Is that
What are you
true?
talking about?
What
With
are you
dead
talking about?
dogs?
Here we go. This is your prophet taking shower with dead dogs. Your prophet is a mentally ill person, my friend. Sorry, I'm sorry to say, I'm not trying to insult you, but this is the truth. You know, here we go. This is the hadith, and this is sahih, where it says that your prophet, he jump in the water, he have a dead dog next to him. Actually, they are pieces. They became pieces, you know, those dogs. I mean, and then there's women, the rags of the women, the women at that time, they use rags. They put them at their private part to observe the blood. They throw the blood there. And not only that, dogs, flesh, and rags of menstruation and garbage are dumped. And you're a prophet, you don't have a problem with that. Read carefully with me the hadith, please. I want you to read carefully. It was said, O Messenger of Allah, you perform wudu from the well into which...
Oh, this hadith, I know this hadith.
Ah, you know it, okay. Tell me about it, go ahead.
Okay, so the well of Buddha, it was the water was running continuously.
Now we have two spring of water in Mecca. We have one is called Zamzam and we have one is called Buddha. My friend,
on top of running water.
No, water there. No, this is a dirty water. You can stand in it. What running water? There's no river. There's no river. Okay, hold on. What if I show you the description of how big it is? And it's not running water. Why you are making things up, Abu Hussein? I mean, you know what? If you can show me that this is running water, you are the hero. Can you show me what it says that? Why you are making things up?
Hold on, let me see.
This is the hadith. Here we go in front of you, and this is sahih. Sorry, the da'if. It says, read with me, Abu Hussein, in the screen. I measured the breadth of the well of Bida with my sheet, which I stretched over it. Look how small it is.
Imam At-Tahawi said that the well of Bida was like a ride leading to a garden. This means that the water is always running and it's not static.
Who is this At-Tahawi? How he knew? Where he got this from? Abu Dawood. No, he's a scholar. He's a potato. Abu Dawood saying, I measured it. Not saying I heard. I measured the breadth of the well of Bida'a with my sheet, look how small it is, which I stretch over it. I then measure it with the hand. It measured 60 cubits in breadth. And I then asked the man who opened the door of the garden for me and admitted me to it, has the condition that will change from what it had originally to been in the past. He said, no, I saw the color of the water in this well had it changed. So nothing changed in the, and this is the size, it's the original size. It's very small one, it's not a running water. And if it's running water, people will not throw garbage in it because the people need to drink. This is a desert. They will kill you actually if you throw dirt in a well which people can drink from. But because this is the dirty water.
Okay, so
and look what it says here. Look,
how would he know that Abu Dawood's measurement was correct?
My friend, it doesn't matter. He's your no, this is your Muslim books. I ask, where does it reach when it is level goes down? He said, he replied, below the private part of the body. So it's 60 cubit wide, and it is less than the private part. Very small, tiny. It's like a jacuzzi place. So we have dead dogs.
What do you mean that small tiny?
It's a small, it's 6 cubit. What do you know what 6 cubit mean?
Yeah, it's around
6 arms, right? 6 arms.
Yeah.
Okay, 6 arms is small. This is the size of my room. And the level of the water is down your private part. Okay. And what is inside the water? Dead dogs. Isn't it enough to have one dog? No, there's dead dogs. What else? Women with blood from period. And what else? Garbage. And not only that, it says, and nothing. The water stink. Read carefully. all of those in six less than 6 meter, 5 meter space of water. Small, tiny jacuzzi. And you're a prophet, yet he is washing himself from that water?
Okay, so let's assume that he did so. Like, what does that do? Like, what does that change?
That's me. Muhammad is crazy because you see the people, they are saying to him, are you doing this? Okay, hold on. Why they are asking him why you are doing that if this is not normal? You tell me.
Yeah, because this is the only water they had.
He is in the city, my friend. He is a city. People walking by. If this is the only water they have, that would be stupid even to wash from. Because this is dirty. It will make you sick. There's corona. Did you hear about corona? So,
yeah,
if you're, are you saying to me, Abu Hussein, if you want to do, okay, are you saying that if you are going to pray and you find a little tiny space of water, have dead dogs and women blood from period and garbage in it, you are going to do the same as Muhammad?
No, that's only for a specific.
Specific. Okay, hold on. So why they are questioning his behavior, the Muslims, why they are questioning? And look what your prophet said. He said, water is not made impure by anything. Do you agree with that?
It's true. Water isn't made impure by anything.
Really? But the piss is a water.
Yeah, what? But like the water itself, H2O, if you look at like the chemistry H2O,
H2O.
it doesn't get damaged by anything.
My friend, what H2O? He is saying that the water always is nothing make it impure. So you are saying to me now, according to your logic, if somebody piss in your water, you have a cup of water, and somebody piss on it, you will drink it because it's a pure. This is what your logic. H2O is not damaged, brother. This is your logic.
If you read another hadith, it talks about the same thing.
Here we go. We are reading here. We have dead dogs. We have garbage. We have women blood from period. And yet Muhammad saying nothing will make it impure. So if you have a cup of water and somebody piss inside it, you as a Muslim, you would drink it happily. Read this hadith with me. The people ask Allah, Messenger of Allah, can we perform ablution?
If something impure falls into a small amount of water, but it does not change any of its characteristics, such as a drop of blood or a drop of urine that falls into a vessel in which there is water, but it does not change, any of its characteristics, it is deemed impure because of the impurity falling into it. Hey, hold on. What does this say?
Okay.
No. Basically, if it doesn't change the characteristics, then it's pure.
So
but
now,
if it doesn't, but if it changes it, then it's impure.
All right. So now, women of blood from period, is it going to change or not?
Yeah. But this water is running.
Where it says running? Show me. It's a well of water, my friend. It's dirty water. It's just, if it's running, then there's no blood will stay. And there's no garbage will be there because it's running. I mean, are you insane? If it's running, it's not going to be six arm wide. This is the size of it. If it's running, that will make it a river, a spring of water.
Like right now, if you go back to
my friend, does it say well of water or it says a spring of water? Does it say well? It's a hole in the ground. And obviously it's a hole in the ground. Nobody uses it for drinking. That's why people throw garbage in it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what does a well do?
The water underneath
keeps flowing.
Okay, hold on. You see, the guy, he measured it. The highest of it is not even for your private part. So it's not, it's a shallow hole in the ground. To the point you can stand there. It's not like a deep down in the ground. It is that little tiny ground, and you can stand all the way to your private part. And you're a prophet. He's just standing there too, doing his evolution.
You can't assume like what was he measuring? Like, what if he was measuring like from the top to the
No, he
ledge
was
of the
measuring
aqueduct?
this, that he covered it by the sheet. Do you understand what covered by sheet? It's mean this is the surface of it. And then he said how high it is. So we get the height, we get the depth of it. That's it. The height is to the private part, less than the private part. And the width of it, which means the size as a space, is he covered by the sheet. All of this have what? And look,
Okay, okay, okay. So, 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 if let's say assume that this happened, what does that mean?
that's mean your prophet is crazy. Because why he want to do that? He live in a city. He live in a town. They have a clean water. Why in the world you want to go and do this?
Didn't Noah drink a lot of alcohol and become drunk?
Who?
According to the Bible, he
Who?
became drunk.
Who?
Prophet Noah.
So what? So?
So then could you say that he's crazy?
Okay. So you are saying to me, if somebody drink alcohol, he's crazy, correct?
Becoming drunk?
If somebody became a drunk, is he crazy? Or because of the alcohol, he became a drunk?
Because of the alcohol.
Thank you. Here, Muhammad is not a drunk, so there's no reason for him to jump in the top of the garbage. You see, if you are drunk, you might do something stupid. Thank you very much. Now, is Muhammad here? Is drunk? Maybe he take hashish? Are you saying your prophet was taking hashish? Well,
Dude,
astaghfirullah, you
what?
need to tell me why in the world somebody have a clean water, he will go and jump there. You need to explain to me. Obviously, you have a mental issue.
Yeah, I don't know about this.
Yeah, and Noah was drunk, guys. Noah, he was drunk. Yeah. Listen, let me ask you. Was your prophet drunk too?
What?
Was your prophet drunk too?
No.
Are you sure?
Yeah, 100%.
Okay, let's see if this is true or not. What is the word wine in Arabic?
Ah, dang, no. I told you I'm not good at Arabic.
Is it Nabith?
Khamar,
Khamr,
is that how you say
okay,
it?
Khamr, and is it what about Nabith?
I don't know that word.
Okay, well, anyway, Nabith, you can go search it in Google. They were making Nabith for your prophet, and he drank from it every day. And not only that, all the Muslims were a drunk people. Isn't it the Quran says, "O you believer, don't get close to the prayer when you are drunk." Yes or
Yeah, it
no?
doesn't say that he was drunk.
Okay, who was drunk?
The people, like
Okay, what kind of
the Muslims.
Muslims they go to the mosque and they are drunk? And what kind of
Yeah,
a
so
prophet?
this was before the prohibition.
Okay, when this was came to be forbidden, is it at the end of Islam? So why Muhammad did not forbid from the beginning?
Yeah, so Allah revealed the Quran in the period of 23
No,
years.
when Muhammad he got sick, he cannot drink no more. Then he forbid the wine because he cannot drink it no more. Did your prophet used to throw up anything he eat because he was dying from poison?
Was he throwing up?
Yeah, because he have pain. He ate poison, and that caused him to die slowly. So he throw up anything he eat. Here we go. This is the hadith. It says, the prophet in his element in which he died, he used to say, "Oh Aisha, I still feel the pain caused
Oh
by the
yeah,
food I
I
ate of
from David
Khaybar."
Wood's channel.
Okay, so Aisha, she's reporting that Muhammad died by poison. Do you know what poison do? Damage
Yeah.
damages organs. Obviously, this guy is dying slowly. He took the poison 3 years ago, yet he is still suffering and dying slowly. And this is telling us that how much Muhammad is suffering. And look what he says, I still feel as the food I ate. So I still, he used to say, this is something always he say, he's in pain. Never stop the pain. What is the pain? He ate. The food went where? The first place it goes in his stomach. Do you agree? Okay, so his stomach is damaged, obviously. He's not observing food normally, and he's dying slowly. So your prophet, he did not forbid drinking wine as long he can drink, but now he's dying, he can't drink it no more. Otherwise, why he's not...
Okay, let me
ask you. Your prophet, when he forbid people to go around the Kaaba naked?
What?
When he forbid the people to go around the Kaaba naked?
I actually remember I was watching your show and you were talking about that.
Why he did not forbid this right away after he took over Mecca? Why he waited until he's almost dying to forbid it? He was watching, enjoying the show. So I am a prophet. I took over the town, and now I am the only one who controlled the town. Why he did not forbid male and female from going naked around the Kaaba? And what exactly the religion they were practicing there?
So I think they were...
I will tell you what they are doing. I think they were playing hide and seek, maybe. What is the religion? What kind of religion is the religion? Around the Kaaba is a practice where women and men, they go naked. Do you know?
I think that was the pagan people.
Exactly. So how Muhammad, he is a prophet of Allah. He forbid wine. But he don't forbid people to go naked around the Kaaba?
No, he did forbid it.
Where?
No.
Okay, this is a challenge between me and you. We have a verse in the Quran about wine. We have a verse in the Quran about hijab. Can you show me a verse in the Quran about not to go naked around the Kaaba? By the way, I wish to go there, by the way. I don't know if this is still happening because I would like to buy a ticket and go. I'm still single, you know?
Yeah, so it says Abu Bakr sent me along with other announcers to Minna to make a public announcement. No pagan is allowed to perform Hajj after this year, and no naked person is allowed to perform the Tawaf around the Kaaba. This is from Sahih al-Bukhari 369.
Thank you very much. So this is not, this is where at the end of Islam. This is at the end. Where was Allah all those years? Why Allah? Why Muhammad, when he was in Mecca, he did not come with the verse says, don't walk around the Kaaba naked, shame on you. Allah did not see them. He was blind. Abu, don't laugh at your prophet, man. Show respect. Come on. You are insulting the prophet.
I'm not laughing at you.
You are laughing because I want to know what kind of God he have the time to make a verse about Suleiman walking down street. And then he heard an ant. And then the ant, she said to the other ant, hide because Suleiman will crush you, brother. So the ant, they start hiding. And then Suleiman, he was smiling. Okay, how wonderful story. Allah, he don't have time all those years to make a verse says, don't go around the Kaaba naked. Which one is more important for Allah? Going around his house naked. This is the first thing Muhammad should say. From the first day he claimed to be a prophet. Shame on you. This is the house of God. Don't walk naked. Okay, so why this is came at the end of Islam, not in the beginning?
It's actually mentioned in Quran, where? Chapter 7, verse 28.
It doesn't say that. Here we go, read it for me. Read it, where it says...
And when they commit a fahisha, they say, we found our fathers doing it, and Allah has commanded us of it. Say, nay, Allah never commands of fahisha. Do you say of Allah what you know not?
Okay, where it says don't go around the Kaaba naked.
This is the meaning.
my friend, you are making things up, your own stories. Where is the meaning? Where is the verse that says don't go around the Kaaba? I want to see it. Fahisha can be anything. Fahisha, you know what? I'm going to go with you, and I'm going to check what this is fahisha here mean. Here we go. This is Ibn Kathir, Al-Qurtubi, Al-Tabari, Al-Jalalain, all of them, right? Okay. Here it says that those people, the women and the men, they used to go around the Kaaba naked. All right. So where Allah, he says, don't go around the Kaaba. This is interpretation of your Muslims. Nowhere in the Quran says that. And Allah did not say, don't do that.
Yeah, this is the verse 728.
No, the verse you are saying to them, it says, they are saying, we learned that from our father. Okay, where in the verse it says, don't do go naked around the Kaaba? Can you show me the verse? Where it says that?
Okay, when they commit fahisha,
my
they
friend,
say,
okay, 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 you know what? I am going to say,
what we found our father is doing what?
Okay, let me ask you. Fahisha, anything is fahisha. Fahisha, worshipping idols is fahisha. Adultery is fahisha.
So all of that.
Okay, so where is the verse says don't go around the Kaaba naked? Nowhere.
this is you
are coming in the interpretation saying to me this is about don't go around the Kaaba. Okay, you know what? I want to go with you. This is a chapter 7. When chapter 7 was given to Muhammad?
Let me see. Chapter 7 was revealed in Mecca.
In Mecca. Okay. What number is number chapter 7, the original number? Do you know?
Sorry, what?
What is the original number of...
Hold on. Chapter 7. One second. Yeah, it's Meccan. Yeah, except for 163 to 170 is from Medina.
Okay. So what is the number of number 7?
Al-A'raf?
No, no, I'm saying to you, this chapter, the one you are saying, Al-A'raf, yeah, it is, what is the official number, not the Quran today you have?
What is the official number?
Yeah, Muhammad, he received Quran, there's according to Revelation, and there's according to the Book of Uthman, correct?
Yeah.
So, Al-A'raf, according to the Revelation, when Muhammad, he received it?
You tell me.
No, I cannot tell you because this is secret. Yeah, I cannot tell you.
Why is it a secret?
You have to work for it. You need to help me here because I want to know how this is in the world happen. If Al-A'raf was given to Muhammad in a certain time, right? Why Al-A'raf is not in the right location? Do you know?
What do you mean by location?
This is here, chapter 7. Is it? This is where Muhammad received it. It was number 7, or this is wrong?
Oh no.
Okay.
No.
Okay. So is this verse here is coming really part of the Al-A'raf?
The Surah Al-A'raf. It was given. Yeah, it was number 39.
Okay. So, is that verse part of really number 39 or part of number 7?
You know, I don't know the answer to that.
Okay, so who is the one who changed the location of this verse? And why this verse is coming in the wrong place? Because you mentioned to me that there's a hadith that the prophet he sent... excuse me, to announce that nobody go around the Kaaba naked. Is that correct?
Yeah.
When this happened exactly?
You know what? I think it's better if you like talk to a scholar about this.
All right. Okay.
I don't have that much knowledge about this.
No problem. We'll skip the topic. We'll go back to zero. I ask you about a prophecy of your prophet. I cannot wait. Even the cat here is like surprised.
Oh yeah. There are a lot. And the first one is in the Bible in Deuteronomy 18:18.
If Muhammad in the Bible.
Yeah.
Okay, tell me what it says there.
Why are you laughing?
Okay, in the book of what?
And in Deuteronomy 18:18,
Okay, what it says, brother? Go.
your laugh is very funny.
Okay, I'm okay. What you can do? I mean, I have to laugh. What it says there? What? Tell me, tell me, tell me what it
Okay,
says.
I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will, from among their brothers, the Arab. I will put my
The
word
Arab
in
are the
his mouth,
brothers. The Arab are
and
the
he will
pro.
tell
Okay,
them
hold
everything
on.
I commanded him.
The Arab are the present. The brothers of the Jews. How that happened? They have one father.
They were brothers.
Who is their father? Who is their father? Who is the
The
father of the
brothers of
Jew?
the Jews.
Who is the father of the Jews?
Abraham.
No. Your Quran says children of Israel, children of Israel. It doesn't say children of Abraham. So their father is Israel. So to be their brother, to be you have to be from the from the kids of Israel.
So
Okay. So what it says there from your brother. Okay, continue. This is the first number one mistake. Okay, continue. What is this? What else?
this is it.
What is that? That's it?
This is the prophecy. This is, I will raise up for them a
If
prophet.
where is your prophet? Where is your prophet? Where it says
Sorry, what?
where is speaking about your prophet? Where is speaking about your prophet there?
I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I commanded him.
You see, in that chapter there's a the part of the chapter number 20 is speaking about the false prophet. Did you read that?
No, which one?
The same chapter 18.
Which verse?
This verse number 20. And this is about your prophet. Now, you
But a
see.
prophet who dares speak a message in my name that I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods.
Thank you.
So,
Where there is nowhere in the Bible,
doesn't.
there is nowhere in the Bible it's mentioned the name of Allah. So here the verse is speaking about your
If you go
prophet.
to the Arabic Bible and you open and you open Genesis, it says Allah created the
Okay,
heavens
this
and
is
the earth.
translation. This is false translation. But in the real
I don't
Bible,
care if it's false.
no, this is
Translate.
false
This is
translation.
what
If
Arabs do.
you
Even
open
Arabs
if you
say.
no, if you open the Quran right now, you will find the name Jesus. But in the Quran, there's no Jesus, correct? Okay,
Risa, you
so this
see.
is false translation, my friend, because you should not translate a name. You should not make up a name. So this is false translation. So now here, you're a prophet. He came in the name of other God. Secondly, you're a prophet. He could not bring any true prophecy. I asked you about true prophecy. You said to me he's mentioned in the Bible, but there's no proof of that. Give me a prophecy of your prophet to make him prophet.
Okay, there are a lot.
Like what?
So the first one would be so it says, "Say, O Muhammad, I do not tell you that I have depositories containing the provision of Allah, nor that I know the unseen, nor do I tell you that I am an angel. I only follow what is revealed to me." For example, the Byzantines will rebound. Like, the Byzantines have been defeated in the nearest land, but they, after their defeat, will triumph within 3 to 9 years. And then in the book, in the History of Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire by Edward Gibbon, it says, "At that time when this prediction is said to have been delivered, no prophecy could be more distant from its accomplishment.
Okay, my friend.
Since the first 12 years of Heraclius announced the approaching dissolution of the empire."
I want you to read this hadith for me in the screen because I'm going to die laughing at you now. Read it.
Which hadith?
Here we go on the screen. I just put it for you on the screen.
I only see a cat.
The cat is the hadith. The cat itself is the hadith. It's coming to you. Just
Okay.
okay. You see it now?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's an area. Okay.
Read it.
On the day of the Battle of Badr, the Romans had what? Had victory over the Persians.
Read.
So the believers were pleased with that. Then the following verse revealed, and it's going to mean the Romans have been defeated.
So the verse came after they've been victorious. What is the prophecy? Let me tell you a prophecy, my friend. Trump, he will win election in 2016. Well, this is what you're saying to me. Muhammad, he made the verse after they've been victorious, not before.
Okay,
so get me something better. I mean, this is stupid. You Muslim don't read, you Muslim don't know your books. That this verse revealed after they became victorious, as you see, you know, in the day of the Battle of Badr, the Roman had victory over the Persian, so the believer were pleased with that. Then the following verse was revealed, Alif Lam Mim. AFDCGO, the Roman being defeated and a few years victorious. I mean, this is stupid. Secondly, why Muhammad is pleased that the Roman is victorious, brother? I thought the Roman are kuffar. At that moment, Muhammad, he was trying to make himself look like a Christian, so he was proud about the Roman, those are my people. Later, he want to kill them. Because he's a hypocrite. Give me. So the first one did not work. The first one, it was a fraud. The second one. Give me another.
It says, may the hands of Abu Lahab be ruined. Mm. And ruined is he. His wealth will not avail him. Mm. Or that which he gained, he will burn in a fire blazing flame.
Okay.
So it is astonishing that for the next 9 years of Abu Lahab's life, despite hearing these verses being recited, his pride still kept him from potential golden opportunity to discredit the Quran. And so had Abu Lahab simply professed faith, even disingenuously, that could have brought into serious question the truth of this revelation.
Okay.
So of course, he who revealed this knew Abu Lahab would never do so.
Okay, so you are saying to me, that if Abu Lahab later became a Muslim, that means Muhammad is a fraud, correct?
If he later became Muslim?
Yeah, because this is about Abu Lahab. Allah is saying, okay. So guys, be my witness. If Abu Lahab became a Muslim later, that means Muhammad is a fraud. But all the Quran was made for those who don't believe in Muhammad, including Khadr ibn Walid was fighting him. Look what it says. It says, are you going to guide the one who Allah made misguide, the one who deceived? So all the Muslims who became Muslims, Muhammad says to them, and you will never be able to guide them, the Quran in front of you.
Which verse is it?
Any verse you want. How many verses you want me to show you? I have tons. I have I have red verses, yellow verses. What do you want? I mean, we have all over. All the Quran says, that those who will, you know, if you try to make them believe, they will never believe. Isn't the Quran says, وَلَنْ تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى, the Christian and the Jews, they will never accept you unless you follow their okay, I'm going with your logic. So if there is one a Christian accept Islam, that means Muhammad is a fraud. Because he said, the Christian and the Jews will never accept you. The Quran says that don't teach them. You teach, you know, you ask for forgiveness or you're not, they will not accept Islam. And later all of them accept Islam.
You said that Abu Lahab became Muslim.
No, I'm saying, no, I did not say that. I said to you, you mentioned to me Abu Lahab.
Okay.
And you said that this is a prophecy. What is the prophecy?
Okay.
That Allah is saying,
he would never.
Okay, so he will never become Muslim. Thank you very much. So I say to you, so if Muhammad, he made verses about people and that they will not accept Islam, and later they accept Islam, that means it's a fraud. You said yes.
But you're saying, okay, show me the verses where he said that they will never accept Islam and they accepted Islam.
Okay, let us see. Chapter 3, verse number 86. As an example, not limited. how shall guide people who have disbelief after they believed? This is about who?
How can I know? How can I know what?
Okay, how Allah is saying to him, to Muhammad, how you can guide people who disbelieve after they became believers?
Okay.
This is about who?
How shall God guide people who disbelieved after they believed? They believed and bore witness that the messenger is true and that the clear signs came to them. God guides the people of the God. It's not okay.
But those people later they became Muslims, all of them.
No, this is talking about people who disbelieved after they believed.
Doesn't matter. He's saying to him, how you can make them believe, which means they will never believe.
No. This is talking about the people who believe and then disbelieve.
My friend, no problem. They believe and then they disbelieve. And he's saying to him, how you can make them believe? But later they became believers.
So the people who used to be Muslim, who left Islam,
okay,
then became Muslim again?
Is this verse talking about a specific person or about anyone?
How shall God guide a people? Well, by the language, by anyone.
Yeah,
so people who left Islam and then after they disbelieved.
Okay.
And then after okay. They believed again.
This person who left Islam, did he become a Muslim again?
Who left Islam?
Uh-huh. No. Because the verse saying, are you going to guide? How shall you guide? How shall God guide a people who disbelieve after they believed? Which means Allah will not guide them. Very simple, right?
No, I don't understand what you're saying.
Allah saying, how God, and this is funny by the way, because he says, كيف يهدي الله. I mean, Allah is talking how he said that. This is very silly. So, how Allah guide people who disbelieve after they believe, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Did those people who Allah is saying how he will guide them after disbelief, which means he will not guide them, did they believe again?
Did they believe again? I don't know.
Read the interpretation. It mentioned many names, and yes, they became believer again. And we have tons of verses in the Quran speaking about the Quran saying that you cannot guide those who Allah misguide. But all of them later, they became Muslims. Muhammad became victorious. And when became victorious, people, they enter into Islam by waves. Go and read the victory chapter. Right? So this is a proof that Muhammad is a false prophet. Because he predicted that they will not believe. Let me ask you, do Allah guide kuffar or Allah guide only Muslims?
No, God guides those who believe in God. And
No. Do Allah guide the kuffar or he don't guide kuffar?
No, he does not.
Okay, guys, Allah, he don't guide the kuffar. So how Khalid al-Walid became a believer? He was a kafir. Umar, he was a kafir. Abu Bakr was a kafir. I mean, this is a joke. You just say to me, Allah will not guide the kuffar.
Abu Lahab didn't become Muslim.
Huh?
Abu Lahab didn't become Muslim.
No problem. Chapter 5, verse number 67 says, Allah guide not the kuffar. Correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Was Abu Bakr kafir before he converted to Islam?
Yeah.
Okay. Was Umar kafir before he converted to Islam?
Okay.
Okay. But the Quran says that Allah guide not the kuffar.
No. The kuffar are those who know Islam and disbelieve.
What do you mean who know Islam? It says Allah, he guide not the kuffar. Anyone is kuffar. Allah, look how many verses. Allah, he guide not the kuffar.
Yeah. So like people who don't know the message of Islam, and then they can't technically be called disbelievers because they don't know what to believe in.
Hmm. But my friend,
Right?
is it God he sent messenger for the kuffar or to the believers? Obviously to the kuffar, because he wanna guide them. So here it says Allah guide not the kuffar, then believer, read it. And that is the most silly, stupid story, because as you are saying, that doctor will not come to the sick, he come only to the healthy. You know, when the Jews they asked Jesus about how he speak to those people, he said, I came to the sick. He came to the sick. So when your God
Okay,
will
can I just
not,
ask you a question?
when your God he says that he will not guide the disbelievers, isn't the Quran says that the disbelievers have sickness in their heart? So they are sick.
Okay.
Okay, shouldn't he help the sick one and guide them? I mean, who is the one who need guidance? The one is guided already, or the one is not guided? You see, until now you fail to give me any prophecy. You know, I want to help you. According to your prophet, how the baby is made? Because it's
The baby.
prophecy. Yeah, this is a prophecy from the prophet. How he how the how the
Oh yeah,
baby?
that's another thing. The
Yeah.
Quran talks about embryology.
Like this, tell me about it. I'm interested.
So you can go on the scientific journal. It's called NCPI, International Journal of Health Sciences.
Interesting, yeah.
And then you can read like the extract and then
Amazing.
the proofs.
Tell me about it, please. Tell me about the Quran first, and then we can compare. According to the Quran, how the baby is made.
I can send you the article if you want to
No
read it.
problem, you can send me as much as you want, but I want you now to tell me. You can read it for us, but now it starts with the Quran. According to the Quran, how the baby is made.
Okay, so if we get the verse out. Right here. Okay, it says, we created a man from an extract of clay, then we made him a drop in a place of settlement firmly fixed. This is like the when the semen and egg gets put together, they get fixed. And then after we made him into a drop of alaka, like a leech, like it looks like a leech. This is what like if you look at early embryology, the zygote actually looks like a leech. And then we made the alaka into like a chewed substance. And this is actually everything about this is correct according to science.
Okay, let me ask you. So, what is the halakha exactly?
It's like a suspended thing or like a leech or like a blood clot.
In which language that's suspended? Where are you coming with this from? Halakha in the Arabic
This is
language,
Arabic.
my friend, no. Halakha in the Arabic language is a dead blood. Read the screen. This is chapter 23, verse number 14. Then we made the sperm into a clot of a congealed blood. What congealed blood mean?
Congealed blood. Yeah, so like a clot of like a clot, a
Okay.
blood clot or like
Does
a
it
or like
say
a leech.
like? Does it say like a like? Or it says we made it a clot? Does it say like a clot? Or it says we made it a clot?
Yeah, so we made it into a like
Thank
a
you.
leech, like a
Don't tell me like
substance.
a leech. It doesn't say that. It says a congealed blood. So your God confirm that the sperm will transform into blood. Is that according to science accurate?
It is accurate
Oh, okay.
because
You said you have a journal. You know what? I will shave my 20-foot beard if you can show me in that journal where it says that the sperm of them. Yeah, you know, you are the one who mentioned to me journal and blah blah blah. Okay, can you show me in that journal where it says that the sperm transform into dead blood,
Okay.
and the dead blood became a lump, and then the lump became bones. Show me where that it says. I want you to read for us. I'm listening. I trust you. I trust you. Don't give me a link. I don't open links. Just
The
read for us.
heart
Just read for us.
begins to. Sorry, what?
Read for us where it says that a sperm, this is the stages. We have a sperm, We made the sperm into, which means the transform is
yeah,
what?
yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah,
Where
yeah.
in the journal
So
it says that the sperm became a clot of a blood?
yeah. So this, like, the meaning, what you're saying is a blood clot. We find that the external appearance of the embryo and its sacs during the alaqa stage is similar to that of a blood clot.
My friend,
so
my friend, my friend, my friend. Hold on, hold on. No, 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 Where it says that the sperm became blood. The sperm, listen carefully. Where in that journal, this is the beginning. The beginning is what? The beginning is a sperm. Number one stage is a sperm. Number two, the sperm itself became a congealed blood. The sperm.
The sperm into
the sperm. Okay, let me ask you. Let me ask you. Abul, you are very educated, not like me. Is a sperm of the man or the woman?
The sperm of the man.
Okay, so according to the journal, the sperm of the man became the baby, and this is the stage: sperm, then a congealed blood, then a lump, then the lump become bones. This is your God explanation for science?
So everything there is correct.
How is that? There's nowhere, nobody in the science say that a sperm became a baby. Sperm go to the woman and fertilize the egg, and that's it. And that this is his duty. He gave the DNA and fertilize, and then the sperm will not be, they will not grow, will not transform to be the baby. This is stupid. The one who will be the baby is the egg. The egg will start splitting cells and grow, and then will, this growth will start giving, like, let us say, in a amazing way, the organs start growing, you know, in stages. But here in the Quran, it's very simple explanation. The sperm became a blood, and the blood became a lump. So in the journal you have, does it say that number one is a sperm? Then number two, the sperm became dead blood. Does it say that?
Well, in the Quran, it says that. Well, if you're trying to look for the word of like, and it's not there. But when it talks about congealed blood, it's talking about it resembles.
Resembles. Okay, my friend. It doesn't say what you are saying. You are making things up, trying to cover off a problem. The sperm became a blood. Okay, you know what? What do you think? Who understands the Quran better, you or your prophet?
The prophet.
Are you sure the prophet? I think the Quran, I think you understand better, man. Are you sure?
What do you mean?
Are you sure the prophet, he knew better than you about the Quran, not you?
Of course.
Oh, okay, of course. Okay, thank that. That's good to know. All right, let us see what your prophet said. Your prophet, he explained to us how the baby is created. I want to ask you, how long the sperm of a man can live?
How long?
Yeah.
People can put their sperm in these.
No. I'm talking about the sperm go inside the woman for how long can live. Don't tell me you put it in the refrigerator. For how long?
So it says, around 5 days.
5 days. Thank you very much. Look what your prophet said. And as you said, you agreed that your prophet knows best, right?
Yeah.
All right. So you are in the stage of a semen in the mother womb for 40 nights. Read it. This is your prophet saying that this is how the stage is. You are in a form of a semen in your mother womb for 40 nights of vacation. This is like a cruise ship full of corona. And then after that, after the 40 days, you will become blood. And after 40 days, read, you know, I will, you know what? Your English is better than mine. I want you to read for me. Go ahead.
The creation of any one of you is like this, that semen is collected in the womb of your mother for 40 nights.
Read this hadith. I just switched the hadith. This is longer. This is giving us more details. Read it for us.
I only see that one.
Okay, it's going to come to you now. Let me say my magic word. Shaksha, shaksha, shakuha. Okay, it's going to go now. You will see it. You see it now?
Yeah, it's okay. The messenger of Allah. Peace be upon him. He is the truthful, the beloved, the believed, narrated to us. Verily, the creation of each one of you is brought together in his mother's womb for 40 days in the form of a nutfa.
Which means sperm. Nutfa means sperm, correct?
Nutfa, oh yeah, I googled this.
Okay.
It could mean the joining together of sperm
no
and
problem.
Egg.
Okay, no problem. So you are 40 days now in a sperm, because in different places it says it clearly it is a sperm. But anyway. So now you are in Nutfa as for 40 days. And then you are a clot of a blood. Does it say clot of a blood? For the same period, 40 days. And then you are a mudra, which means a flesh, a piece of a flesh, for the same period. That's it. The baby is finished. The total is 120 days. 40 days, you are a sperm. Then 40 days, you are a blood. And then 40 days, you are a flesh. Bingo.
Yeah, this is all correct.
What?
This is all correct.
How is that? The baby is 40 days blood.
Okay,
let me ask you. The first 40 days of the baby, he's a blood? He's a sperm?
He's the zygote.
He's what?
The zygote.
What the zygote? It says a drop of a sperm. A drop of a sperm. Not far. So for the first day, 40 days, you are a sperm. Do you agree with that? And then the second stage, the sperm will become blood. Do you agree with that?
Hold on. Well, why don't you call a doctor and ask him these questions?
Aren't you a doctor? I thought, you are talking about the Dr. Muhammad now. This is Dr. Muhammad. We are talking to my friend. Are you insulting the, this is Dr. Muhammad. Hello? Come on, please show respect,
okay.
My friend. This is Dr. Muhammad himself talking. There is no way, Dr. Muhammad will say something not true. I mean, there's no way. I mean, brother, come on. This is not true, right? So, 40 days, read with me here. When 40 days, hold on, let me show you here. When 42 nights pass after semen get into the wombs, Allah sent his angel to give him his sheep. Unbelievable. This is a pure science, Abu Hussein, man. This is so good to be true. This is so beautiful. So you are 40 days as a sperm. And then now Allah decides to work. Okay, let us see different hadith. I'm just showing you what your prophet, because the prophet is explaining us the Quran. Read with me. It says here, the creation of everyone starts in with this process of collecting material of his body within 40 days and 40 nights in the womb of his mother. Then he became a clot. This is the first 40 days. Remember, this is a sperm. The second 40 days, you are just a clot of a thick blood. You know, Abu Hassan, my mother, she told me, since you were thick blood, you were thick. Unbelievable. True story. Unbelievable. Okay. And for a similar period of time, 40 days, then he became like a piece of a flesh. 40 days. And then Allah, he sent the angels to write his destiny. That's it. The baby is done. 40 days a sperm, 40 days a piece of blood, thick blood, and 40 days a piece of meat. Bingo. We have Abu Hassan now. That is science. That is science,
okay,
my friend.
I think so. After this 120-day period, the baby starts to grow.
No, he says he's finished now because he's writing his life. That's it, he's done. My friend, don't you see? Don't you see? Don't you read? That's it. Then Allah, he sent the angel, and he decide. And according to your prophet, the last thing Allah, he decide is male or female. The angel asked Allah, is it going to be male or female? According to science, the first thing happen is decided already, is the male or female, because the sperm decide the gender of the baby. That's it. So what your prophet is talking about, obviously your prophet is a false prophet. Okay, let me ask you, are you married?
I'm not.
Don't get married, man.
Why?
Women these days are scary. Because I heard that women, they have, don't know what to say to you, they have testicles in their chest.
What do you mean?
Well, isn't it the Quran said that Allah, He created the baby from the sperm of the man, from the backbone, and the sperm of the woman from the chest location, which is specific location of the necklace? Does the Quran says that or no?
I don't know.
Okay, this is a chapter 86, verse number 7. Do you have interpretation for it?
For which one?
Chapter 86, verse number 7.
Chapter 86, verse 7.
Yeah.
Yeah, issuing from between the backbone and the breastbone.
So what do you think? What does this mean?
Yeah, so that's actually true. If you look at the embryo, where the sperm emerges, it does come from between the backbone and the breastbone.
Mean the embryo is the sperm now? I don't know.
No. So
Okay.
like the place where the sperm comes out, it if you look at the human body, if you look at these like the spine and then the backbone and then the breastbone, the sperm actually comes from between them.
Yeah, but this verse is not talking about one person, I'm talking about two. It's talking about the man and the woman. You know what? What interpretation would you like me to show you for this verse? Whatever you say, I'm going to accept. No problem.
Of which interpretation?
Yeah, to understand this verse, so I will. We will not be fair. I don't want to name my own. Give me interpretation. Says okay, whatever he says, we accept. We go with it.
Zakir Naik.
Zakir Naik now have interpretation.
Yes.
Since when Zakir Naik have interpretation? What happened to Ibn Kathir? You
Well,
sold him?
you love him so much, so you can go stuck your
No,
neck.
I'm asking you seriously. Which book you want me to show you interpretation for it?
Yeah, why not? In Zakir Naik.
There's no something called Zakir Naik. Who's Zakir Naik? Anyway, come on. Give me a book of a scholar you accept, please.
Atale.
At-Tabari. Okay, At-Tabari. Guys, he said At-Tabari, but we don't have Tabari in English. Do you know Arabic? He said no. There's no. Do you have a Tabari in English? We have to show you in English. What about Ibn Kathir? Is that okay, Ibn Kathir?
Okay, but like.
Okay, let us see Ibn Kathir. Chapter 86, verse number 7. Let us see. This is the official website. Okay.
Can I just ask why you love Zakir Naik so much?
You know, he's really smart, super smart. He is most, actually, he's the most smart Muslim ever I met. I mean, I have to admit, we speak many languages. I don't understand any of them. Let us read what Ibn Kathir is saying. I want you to read carefully with me. This is Ibn Kathir. Read, go ahead. Let us read from here. Is it coming to you?
Yeah.
Okay, read for me.
Yeah, so it says, he is created from a water gushing forth, meaning the sexual fluid that comes out, bursting forth from the man and the woman. Thus, the child is produced from one, from both of them by the permission of Allah.
Okay.
Due to this, Allah says, yeah.
All right. Now we continue reading. It says here, continue that second part.
Proceeding from between the backbone and the ribs, meaning the backbone or loins of, I can't read it.
Come on, you can.
No, it's not on the screen.
What about now? It's not the screen still.
Because your name is covering it.
No, I moved it already. I moved it up. So you should have it.
Oh, right. There you go. So the backbone or loins of the man and the ribs of the woman. Referring to her chest.
So,
okay.
So the sperm is a sperm of the man coming from the backbone, and women have a sperm coming from her chest. Do you agree with that?
Okay. Yeah, this is only like an interpretation. This is not like.
Okay. So this is interpretation.
Yeah. Like if you show me a hadith that says that this is talking about the woman.
All right. Let us see. Do you know, like, if a man have orgasm first, or a woman have orgasm first, is that going to affect the gender of the baby?
What do you mean by orgasm?
Orgasm. You don't know what orgasm? Pepsi Cola, you know? Orgasm.
Okay.
Yeah. So, orgasm, if a man have orgasm first or the women have orgasm first, is that going to decide the gender of the baby and how the baby look like?
No.
Okay. Well, how you explain to me your prophet? Here we go. This is the hadith. Explain bin al-sulbi wa al-tara'ib. The prophet said, the messenger of Allah said, the man water is thick and white and the woman water is thin and yellow. Which of them comes first? The child resembles the parent. And you said no. Everybody heard you. So you just got your prophet busted. So you're a prophet saying that there's a water come from the woman, coming from her chest, and that is yellow. So Muhammad, he think women have a sperm, and that is a water she see in her private part. And the man have a sperm, and that what is thick and white. And whichever of them comes first, the baby resembles the parent, which means male or female. What do you think about this disaster?
The man's water is thick and white, and the woman's water is thin and yellow. Whichever of them comes first, the child will resemble that parent. Okay, so what's wrong with this?
A second ago, I asked you, if the person have orgasm first, is that going to affect the gender of the baby or the look? You said no. You remember? A second ago. You're a prophet saying exactly what you ask you.
No,
I ask
this
you.
This is right. No.
What do you mean right? You said
water.
No. You said wrong. You said no. You said I asked it to you. If a man have orgasm first or the women have orgasm first, is that going to affect the look or the gender of the baby? You said no.
What does it mean by coming first? Like
coming first, have an orgasm first. You didn't know. Come on. Now you didn't know what orgasm mean. Let me explain to you what orgasm means. Okay. Now, you are walking down the street, okay? And then there's an apple tree. And then the apple tree, one apple fell in your head. You walk up, you find yourself having orgasm. I mean, how in the world you are a man you do not know come first means? This guy wanna convince me that he do not know what comes first means. And I believe it, yeah.
Okay. This is sunnah and sahih. Okay. This is like sahih hadith?
No, this is not sahih. This is da'if. So what? If it's da'if, it's a problem now?
If it's da'if, then you can't trust it.
Okay, what if it's sahih? Can we trust it?
Well, is this sahih?
We can make it sahih for you. Here we go. I use my magic. It's sahih. Here we go. It became sahih. It was da'if a second ago. You know, up to the request. What do you want? You want make it da'if? We make it da'if. You see, this hadith have orgasm now. It became sahih. Before it was without orgasm, it's not sahih. So where is the knowledge and where is the prophet? This is not a prophet. This is a false prophet. He is saying that the sperm of the man coming from the ribs, from the backbone, which is false. Look like your prophet. He never heard of something called testicles. Your prophet, he think testicles is decoration. Maybe they are like a Christmas tree light. Do your prophet know what testicles is about? How in the world do you think that a sperm is coming from the backbone? What is the testicles for? They are decoration. They are the men. They carry them just like for balance, to show off. That's why they say he have a big balls. I thought they have a job, but look like it just like to prove that he is an ox. What kind of religion? This is wrong, right? Thank you very much, Abu Hussein. He just said this is wrong. So how he can be a prophet making a prophecy? Supposedly he is saying something nobody knows.
Man's water is thick and white, and the woman's water is thin and yellow. Whichever of them comes first, the child will resemble that parent.
So
yeah,
what?
That's wrong.
That's wrong. Thank you very much. Here we go. He's an honest man. So this is false prophet. You just said Muhammad is wrong. What do you want more? You left Islam, my friend.
Yeah, because like I don't like if it's wrong that I don't know like if
Come on, easy in the keyboard. Otherwise, the keyboard will have orgasm from his chest.
Yeah, I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know? You are smart. Come on, this is not a prophet. You know? Do you know the story when a guy he came to your prophet and he said to him, "I will ask you three questions. Nobody know the answer for them." Do you know the hadith?
Sorry, what?
There's a guy he came to your prophet. And he told him, "I'm going to ask you a question. Nobody know the answer for them except a prophet of God." Do you know the story?
No.
Okay, let me show you. A guy, he came to the prophet. His name is Abdullah ibn Salam. And he said to the prophet, "I will ask you about three things, which nobody knows unless he's a prophet." Do you see the hadith on the screen?
Not yet.
Okay, let me use my magic.
Oh, there we go.
Okay, see my magic working. Okay, he said to him, firstly, you see, when a Muslim say firstly, it means a disaster is coming. Firstly, what is the first portent of the hour? What is the first meal of the people in the paradise? And what make a baby look like its father or mother? Oh, here we go. Let us go and cut the cheese, not to waste our time. Muhammad, he said, just now, Jibreel has informed me. So you see, Allah is telling Muhammad, this information came from Allah, Jibreel himself. He said, okay, what he told you? He said, regarding the baby, and if the man discharge proceed that of the women, then the baby will resemble the father. And if the women discharge, they precede the man, then the child resembles the mother. And who told him that? Jibreel. Unbelievable. You know, Jibreel, the god of the watermelon. What is that, Abu Hassan? What do you think, Abu Hussein? This is Jibreel told him that.
And if the man starts to down the woman, And the child resembles the father. Yeah, no, that's. And the woman discharge proceeded out of the man, and the child resembles the mother. Wait, which hadith is this?
This is Daif Hadith.
Like what's the number of the hadith?
Number of the hadith, da'if, two da'if, three da'if, four da'if, five, seven da'if.
What is it?
It's okay. So what do you think now? And look, the guy, he converted to Islam. He said, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. After hearing this, Abdullah, he said, I testify that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah, and you are truly a messenger of Allah. And look how stupid the story. The guy, he told them in the beginning, I will ask you questions. Nobody knows the answer for them except a prophet. But yet he knew the answer for them, which means he's a prophet too. Do you see? It says, I will ask you, Abu Hussein, read with me. I will ask you about the three things which nobody knows unless he be a prophet. Does it say that?
Unless he be a prophet.
Okay. Now the guy agree with the prophet that this is the correct answer. That means he's a prophet too.
These are chief sense of hope. We are more protected than this. What do you mean he's a prophet too?
Well, if I say to you this information nobody knows unless he is a prophet from God, and I know it already, I know the answer for it, that's mean I'm a prophet too. The one
What
is
do you mean
asking
another
the
answer?
okay, the one is asking the question, he is saying the answer for this, nobody knows the true answer unless he is a prophet, correct?
Yeah.
But he knew the answer because he agreed with it. So now we have two prophets. We have Muhammad the prophet and Abdullah ibn Salam prophet. And this is Sahih al-Bukhari, my friend. This is very Sahih. And this is Hadith number, book number 60, Hadith number 7. Hadith
Yeah,
number
I
7.
like. Can you like prove this from like the Quran, like not the Hadith?
My friend, I just showed you. You give me your own interpretation. So I showed you Ibn Kathir for the Quran. It says as-sulbi wa at-tara'ib. At-tara'ib in Arabic is a bone of the woman in her the location of the necklace specifically. So there's no way to mix. It is at-tara'ib of the woman. It is the backbone of the man. And this is the most stupid statement ever. And isn't it enough that your prophet coming to say to us, the woman water is thin and yellow, and the man water is thick and white? So he compared the sperm of the man to the yellow liquid the woman she see in her private part when she's having sex. That is stupid. So your prophet, he think that water make the baby, and that water make the baby. So the water of the man and the water of the woman, they mix together. And the water of the man is thick and white, and the water of the woman is yellow and thin, and that make the baby.
I see. Yeah, because if that's the case, then that's wrong.
Okay, so are we out of Islam or not yet?
I think I still have to do a bit more research.
We are doing research. I'm going to stay with you until coming week. I'm not going to go to sleep for the coming 5 days, no problem. Yeah, I mean, what you are trying just to get an excuse, I was, and you are trying to get us to escape the, saying I am out of Islam. I'm not going to let you go. Give me your hand. Let me handcuff you before you leave. Yeah, because you might escape. Come on, be honest. What is missing? I did not prove to you to be wrong. Be honest with me.
Can you show me this from the Quran?
Proof from the Quran, I just showed you. This is from the Quran. The Quran says that the sperm became a congealed blood. That is stupid. The Quran says that the blood became a flesh. That's stupid. The Quran says that a sperm coming from the man, backbone, and the ribs of the women. That's stupid. Okay, hold on. Let me show you something very easy. Do you know what hail is?
Hail?
Hail, yeah. Like the ice
Like
come
the
from the sky, frozen
frozen
rain. Okay.
water.
How this happened, you know?
I don't know, actually.
If I show you that Allah, he said, that Allah, he sent hail from mountains in heaven, is that isn't enough proof for you that Allah is a fraud?
Hail
Yeah.
from heaven?
Yeah.
You can technically say that outer space, not outer space, but like the sky
No.
is
See,
like a set.
Abu, listen carefully. The Quran says specifically that Allah, he sent hail from mountains in heaven. As simple as that. There's mountains, and from those mountains, Allah, he sent hail, which means he break hails from those mountains, he sent it to us. Isn't it this is enough to prove to you that the Quran is a fraud?
Sends down from the sky, massive clouds, wherein is this
No, the
hail?
translation here is false. This is false translation. You see here, this says cloud, it's not exist. This says sky, mountain, masses of cloud, it's not exist. This is a lie. It doesn't say cloud, it doesn't say anything. Cloud is only in the beginning. And then he continue. And he sent down from the sky, from mountains, where in here. If we change the translation, let me show you. This is Yusuf Ali translation. I will change the translator and you will see how the translation changed. Let us see this guy, Hilali and Khan, what they will say. And he sent down from the sky hail between two brackets like mountains. It doesn't say that. Or there are heaven mountains of hail. Where he sent down hail and he strike with it. Oh boy. So they are trying to cover it. They say there's two options. But the fact it doesn't say that. The Quran said the second part. He sent hail from mountains and he strike with it the one who don't like. How this is can be from God? You know what? Let us see if this is what it's meant. I'm going to go to the interpretation. Chapter 24, verse number 43. 24. 43. And right away you will see in a second that when they translate the Quran, they are trying to cover the scam. Read carefully with me, my friend. This is a Jalalain. It says, and he sent down from heaven out of the mountains. Do you see it?
Out of the mountains.
How that can be from God? I mean, this is simple. You do not need to be genius to know that this is
Wait, hold on.
this is false.
So, okay. So when it says breaking up the like the breaking up the you're saying mountains, that's actually like a metaphor for evaporation.
My friend, there's no metaphor. It says, you see, we don't want to lie to each other here. It says, he sent down from mountains, not like mountains. He did not say the same as if it's mountains. I mean, the Arabic is so clear. وَيُنْزِلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مِنْ جِبَالٍ فِيهَا. And this is the accurate translation. He sent down from the heaven out of mountains, min jibalin,
Okay,
min extra
can I
that
ask a
are.
question from the Bible?
But why do you want to change the topic now?
Just about Genesis 1.
Why you want to change the topic? Okay, ask me about Jesus. What about it? But you promise me when I go back here?
Yeah, I will.
Okay, what the question? Go
So like in Genesis 1,
ahead.
it said in verse 3, it said, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. So does that mean God didn't know before that the light was good?
No, good for us. You know, this is, you see, the book of Genesis is not telling us everything God he do. Otherwise, if God want to tell us how he created the eye, we need to have maybe 100 book. You know, when a doctor he study the eye, how many book he study? tons of books just for a little tiny eye. So we are talking about the creation of the universe in a simple way, so people, they might understand that everything is created by God. So God, he created light, and he saw light is good for us. So light is good for what? Good for us.
So he didn't know before that. No,
this is not about, you see, this is introduction. Why God, he decided that the light is good. He saw that the light is good. So
he saw it. That means before he didn't know.
No, okay, I will go with you. God do not know that the light is good. So how he knew it's light? How he knew that there's something?
He saw the light.
No, you see, when he said let be light, it's mean God, he knew what light is. Otherwise he would not say let be light.
Yeah, and then after he saw that it was good.
No. After he knew what is light, for he is the light of the world. That's what the Bible says too. So when God, he says, let be light, he knew already what light is. Otherwise, how you can create something you do not know what it is? It's like saying to me, I'm going to create a car, but I do not know what car. That would be silly, isn't it? So when he saw the light, it was good. Then he spread the light out, which means the light now is perfected for us. It's ready for use, and that is the second stage. Then he spread the light from separated the light from darkness. So here is not about God, he saw and he found out. This is about God. He's, you know, now the light is good for to go for the second stage, and then we will go second stage and we separate from darkness and light and darkness and light.
But it talks about trees being created before the sun, so I don't understand how the trees can.
Okay, I will go with you. The light exists already, correct?
Which light?
The first thing he said, "Let be light."
Which light is that?
It doesn't matter. There's a light. What the trees need? What the trees need light, correct?
The sunlight.
No, not necessarily. As long as God, he created light, there's light. So already he spread between darkness and light. So light exists. So the source of light exists. How it worked, this is the beginning of the creation, we do not know. Secondly, if you are saying how the trees are created before the light, let me show you something. And I want you to be consistent. Do you see the screen?
It's stuck at that the tafsir.
Yeah, hold on. Let me change it. For some reason, the website is stuck too. Let me see what's happening here. I hope I'm not losing my internet.
Oh, where are you from?
You see, I will tell you my story now, but this is a very sad story. This is between me and you. Is that okay?
Okay.
Well, my dad, he was hijacking an airplane, and my mom was with him, you know. She was, like, carrying me. It was, like, the month number 14. So, anyway, he tried to land in Switzerland. They did not give him refugee because he is from Al-Qaeda. So he flied all the way to the Trade Center. And they hit the Trade Center, and I was born there. So that you can say, like, I'm from the Trade Center.
Okay.
I don't know what happened to this website. It's not opening. I think they are doing maintenance to it. Let us see the other one. Yeah, it looked like the Hadith website is not functioning. Because your prophet, he said that Allah, he created the sun in Wednesday, and he created... you know what? Why I want to even open the Hadith? Let's go to the Quran. Just wait. You see, because I'm trying to see how consistent you are. Because if you have a problem with the sun created at the fourth day, what the Quran says that the sun created at the end, in one of the chapters of the Quran. I don't know what happened to my browser. I hope it's nothing wrong. Let us see. Nothing is functioning. Okay, let us see. No, it's not working. What happened? Let's try a different website. Look like those they are doing maintenance in that website.
Which website?
The Qur'an and Qur'an that wall.
QuranWow.com?
Yeah, for some reason.
Yeah, I could open it.
You can?
Yeah.
Okay, let me try a different browser. It keeps saying to me searching and it's not opening the thing.
I can put it up. Which verse are you talking about?
Hold on, let me see, because I want to show it anyway. I will open search truth. All right, yeah, this website is working here. Let's see.
You're either from Egypt or Iraq.
Well, I don't know. I mean, see, because I told you, like, my father, he was like all over the place. You know, he my cousin Osama bin Laden, you know, by the way, he said hello for you.
Osama bin Laden is still living in the White House.
No, actually, he is now. He said to you from the fish tank. I have no idea what is happening. Okay. Okay, look, I have to find, I think I have a problem with my internet. But anyway, finally okay. It's open. Okay, can you open for me? I will show it to you on the screen. Finally, the search.com is opening, not the Quran.
Okay.
Yeah, so if we go read chapter number 41, and I will put in the screen for you, I will show a translation. All right. Okay, verse number 11. It says here that Allah, after He created the earth, and He finished the earth, and He finished everything in 4 days, and He make everything in 4 days, including the grass, the water, everything. Then, He went to the sky, and the sky was a smoke, which means was nothing. And then after that, He completed them, and He made them seven firms in 2 days. And after that, He created the stars. According to you, you are saying, how God created the sun in the fourth day in the Bible. According to the Quran, Allah created the sun at the end. The last thing.
Where does it say that the sun was created the last day?
Read it from, this is chapter 41. Read from verse number 9, 10, 11, 12. You will see it.
So do you reject the one who created the earth in 2 days? Are you attribute equals to him that is the Lord of the universe? He placed stabilizers over it and blessed it and planned its provisions in 4 days, equally to the seekers. Then he turned to the sky, and it was smoke, and said to it and to the earth, come willingly or unwillingly. Then said, we come willingly. So he completed them as seven universes in 2 days, and he assigned to each universe its laws, and he decorated the lower universe with lamps and for protection. That is the sign of the Almighty.
Okay, so the first, the last thing, it was the light, the stars, the last thing in Allah creation.
Okay.
Well, you are saying how there was a trees without star, without a light,
and the Bible say that there were plants.
The verse, here we go, read with me, my friend. In verse number 10, it says, he set earth, mountains standing firm, high above it, and bestowed blessing in the earth, and measure all things, giving the measurement. Do you see measurement? ومرعاها. You know what مرعاها mean? مرعاها. مرع is the grass for the animals.
Okay.
The greenery. So now we have trees, we have a greenery, we have a grass, we have water, and then Allah he start walking in the sky.
That's verse 12.
So in the Bible it says that God from the beginning he created light, so we have light already. So the universe not without light, there's light, but the star, which is we know as a sun today, is created in the fourth day, which means already there is light. In the Quran there was nothing. The last thing Allah he created, it was the stars.
Wait, it says
So this
he
is a big problem.
Stabilizers over it and blessed it and plant its. Wait, it doesn't say plants.
No, my friend, it says وَأَخْرَجَ مَرْعَاهَا. الْمَرْعَى is the food of the animals, the grass, the trees. مَرْعَاهَا. So it says that. You can read the interpretation, any interpretation you want.
Okay.
Yeah. And you know, let's see if the website. This website, you see, I was trying to open it. It says the connection has time out. I was trying to open it, but it wasn't working. Here we go. Now it's opening. Let us see. Look what your prophet, he said. And I'm sure you heard this from the Muslim saying to you, the Bible says that God created the sun in the fourth day. How that can be? This is wrong. But look, in a second, you will see the Muslim, they will still accept, because their prophet, he was copying from the Jews. Look what it says here. This is your prophet talking, not me. Allah, the Exalted, the Greatest, created the clay in Saturday, created the mountain in Sunday, created the trees in Monday, and he created the entire labor in Tuesday, and he created the light in what? Do you see it? Wednesday.
Where is this from?
This is Sahih Muslim.
Oh, there we go. Go. It says Thursday.
The light in Wednesday.
It says Thursday.
The light in Wednesday. He created the light in Wednesday.
The hadith on top of it said Thursday.
Where? It's the same hadith. It's exactly the same hadith.
Scroll up.
No, it says the same. He created the light on Wednesday. He spread the animals and all kind of in Thursday. So light is in Wednesday. You see it? Before that, there's no light. In the Bible, there is light from the beginning, before all those things are created. In according to Muhammad, light was only in Wednesday. And that is additional proof that Muhammad is a false and a fraud. Because here, not only he is contradicting himself, he is lying. For if you count the words here, you will find that the total number of the creation is 7 days, not 6 days. The Quran says Allah created the earth and the heaven in 6 days. Read with me.
Yeah.
Saturday, this is number one. Sunday, two. Monday, three. Tuesday, four. Wednesday, five. Thursday, six. Friday, seven. But the Quran says Allah created the earth and heaven.
Adam is not heavens and the earth.
No, my friend, you see, he created, this is the creation, doesn't matter. This is the creation, because the Quran says Allah created what is in heaven and earth in 6 days, not only the earth.
Does it say that, or it says that he created it in the heavens and the earth in 6 days?
Exactly, which means whatever between them is in 6 days. Adam is.
I think it's talking about like the actual mass itself, like the earth itself.
No, the earth and the heaven, whatever is inside them, is created in 6 days. And then when he say the order is wrong too. Like I just showed you in chapter number 41 that the last thing Allah created was the stars, correct? And you agreed, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. But if you go to different verses in the Quran, you will see that the stars are created in the beginning. Totally the opposite. If you go here, chapter 79, as an example, verse number, you can read it from, let us see.
Can I ask you about Christianity?
No problem, but why you don't leave Islam first and then you can ask me? Here we go. I mean, look at this. Chapter 79, it says that Allah created the earth. And then he raised, he created the sky first. This is number one. This is 79. Then he raised the sky. Then he made the day and the night, which means there's the stars. And then after that, he made the earth flat. And then after that, he made the grass. But in the chapter 41 is the opposite. In chapter 41, it was totally the different direction. It was the grass first. It was the it was the earth, and then the mountains, and then the grass, and then the stars. Here, it is the sky.
When it says "and then," it doesn't mean like by time.
No, my friend, it's me. It says not only "and then." It says "والأرض بعد ذلك," and after that, not only then. Arabic is so clear. والأرض بعد ذلك, and after that. Yeah. So after that means after that. Come on. Right? So this is in order. So, and after that, he did this and this and that. So, it's obvious that this is a total contradiction. Chapter 41 saying the opposite. Allah, he finished the earth, then the mountains, then the grass, the trees, then the light. Here, the opposite. Here, the sky. He made the light. After that, he started working in the earth. And after that, he made the grass and the water. And after that, he put the mountains. Totally, 100% the opposite.
Mm-hmm.
So how this can be from God? God don't remember which one he created first? He's confused? One chapter he says something, in the other chapter he said the opposite?
The Bible also has like so many contradictions.
No. You see, this is contradiction for the ignorant, with my respect to you, my friend. But look what you just said. You just said also in the Bible is contradiction, which means you just admitted that the Quran is full of contradiction. Correct?
Like how many women went to the, how many women went to the cave to see Jesus? Was it like 2, 3, 4?
My friend, that will not change anything, and that is not a corruption, and that's not a contradiction, because everyone he report in the story what is he believe it's important. Secondly, if I wrote a story about Jesus, which is what happened, and the other disciple will write the same story, there's no point to write it exactly the same. So we have to cover what is not mentioned. So you think this is different information? The fact it's not. This is why there's four people describing more additional information. Because if the four they will write exactly word by word, then why we need four? Do you understand what I'm saying? If all of them they will write exactly word by word, then there is no need for having four books. One is enough. So each one of them is giving us additional information to let us say. To cover more of the story, so four writers, four reporters, and every one of them is inspired to cover what is need to be covered. So there's no contradiction, and that is the most silly statement ever you can say, that this is a contradiction.
So
imagine, Abu, I have four books.
Do you have the original Bible?
Sure, we have. We have thousands of manuscripts, thousands. You Muslim don't have anything.
But if you look at what your scholars say, they say the majority of those thousands, they're from like very early on, after like hundreds of years.
No, my friend, we have even older than the manuscript. We have the mosaic. We have the historian. We have all kind. Actually, there's no book in the whole world. You see, there's a guy who is anti Christianity. He hated Christianity. He said that there's no book is more valid and documented more than the Bible. Yet he's against Christianity, but he admitted that there's no book in the world have enough reference and proofs as much as the Bible. yet he hid the Bible. So you cannot go in that direction. Now, before we go and switch for Christianity, you can ask me as much as you want, but why we don't say, you just admitted that this is contradiction, this is false, why you don't say I'm out of Islam?
It's like very, like very hard to say it.
Why not? Why not? It's very hard to say it. What does that mean? I mean, what is it? You know, you are a human being. You have a brain, and you are using your brain. It's hard to use your brain.
It's like, what if this is a test from Allah?
Well, Allah, look at this Allah. This Allah is an idiot. Don't you see? Test from Allah. I spank Allah every day. People are dying laughing at him. He's a joker. How does God can be God? He think. I mean, after all of this, you say test from Allah. Isn't it the Quran says? Isn't it the Quran says? If this not, is book from not Allah, from not from Allah, you will find a lot of contradiction.
Yeah.
Okay, that's it. He just got you. He got himself busted. Allah Himself saying, if this book is not from Allah, then you will find a lot of contradictions. And we found many. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ Don't they consider the Quran? If this is a book not from Allah, you will find a lot of contradiction. You know, contradiction. Chapter 4, verse number 82. And we prove to you many of them. Come on. Be brave, Abu. Come on, you are the man.
Can I like call you back tomorrow?
You can call me tomorrow, the day after. You know, by the way, tomorrow, I'm not, already I'm tomorrow. You can call me now. Here we go. It's already 1 a.m. in the morning for me. So you, it's tomorrow. Call me now. Call me. Come on. Just to say, I'm out of Islam, my friend. Come on. I mean, you are smart and you agree that this is wrong. This is stupid. Already you said you're a Muslim, not a Muslim no more, because you said this is wrong. You said that Muhammad saying wrong. By saying such a statement, you just agree that Muhammad is false.
Like, this is going to change, like, my entire life.
So what? Change. Change for better. So be smart. You know, you were a fool yesterday. Today, you are a smart person. Nobody can fool you. This is a change for good.
I can call you tomorrow.
No, why you don't say now? I am out of Islam. I want to know what's happening. Why you cannot say it? You just admitted that Muhammad is wrong. What is missing? By saying such a statement, you said Muhammad is a fraud. What kind of God is God? This God, this is a God. This is an idiot. If I watch Mickey Mouse, he can teach me something smarter.
So many people in the chat are like, he's gonna leave. He's gonna leave.
Don't worry about people in the chat, my friend. Worry about yourself, about your salvation. This is cult. You are a follower of a cult, my friend. Who care about people in the chat? Who care even about me? This is about you. See, for me, you became a Muslim, you became a Christian, you became a Hindu. This is your business. But voluntarily, for the sake of my Lord, the Messiah, based on love, I'm trying to help you as my little brother as much as I can. I cannot force you. I cannot tell you what to do. I can ask you, what do you think? Why you don't say Islam is false? Already you did. Why we cannot be brave and say the truth? I know, you know, already you are convinced that Islam is false. Why you don't want to say it?
It's just like it's like been like my entire life, like from
So what? You know, if somebody is smoking all his life and then one day he find that smoking is very harmful, should he stop smoking or continue? We have to make a smart decision, all my friend. It's not about all my life. So what of all my life? If all my life was wrong, should I continue wrong?
Okay, I'm out of Islam.
Wonderful. I'm happy for you, my friend. Smart person. He's out of Islam. Thank you, Lord. My time was not wasted. And Abu Hassan, who challenged me, he said, "Why you are afraid to debate me?" In the beginning, now he let us know. Is it very funny, Abu? You challenge me. Why you are a coward? You are a brave, brave. Call me. I will call you. You carry. All right. Now it is time for the good time. Forget about the filthy Muhammad and the garbage of Muhammad. Here we go, Christian Prince, in your service. How I can help you, my friend, about Christianity?
Okay, so like my main question is like the Christians believe that God had to come and like die for us. Like, I don't get that. Like, why would he have to come and die?
No, first of all, nothing is called had to come. Nothing is called had to die. That's not absolutely false. You see, Jesus, he said, "For God, he loved the world, he sent his only begotten son. For he loved the world, not because he have to. Nobody have to. Nobody have to. He love us. Because he love us, he want to save us." So you got a wrong idea about Christianity. Christ, he love you, he love me, he love all the Muslims, he love all the Hindus, he love all the Buddhas. He want to save everybody, every single one. The Bible says a happiness will be in the kingdom of God, our Father, if one soul is saved. Imagine how important your soul is. So, because he loves you, not because he have to, because this is for your sake, not for his sake. It's me and you who might go to heaven or to hell, not him. He's not worried about himself. So he love to help you, not he have to help you. Anything else?
So you're saying that God just like he did it because he just wanted to, he wanted to?
My friend, God, he created Adam and Eve according to the Bible to share his glory with them, like to give them the glory to live with him, not to commit
So
sin.
like if I wanted to become Christian, like would I have to go to like a Catholic church?
And then. This is not the question. Now, who care about Catholic Church or Protestant Church? This is not really important. The what make you saved, my friend, is not a Catholic Church or a Protestant Church or Orthodox Church. It's not a church who save you. It is Jesus the Christ. So if you want to be saved, you believe in Jesus the Christ, not in a church name. We don't care for a church. For me, I don't care if I am a Catholic or Protestant. Or what does this have to do? The bishop cannot save me. The Pope cannot save me. Nobody can save me. Only one name. That is the Messiah. So for you, if you want to be saved, you have to believe in the Messiah, the Lord. He is the Savior, not a Christian prince. I am a sinner, my friend. The bishop is like me. The Pope is like me. We are men. We commit sin. We are made full of sin, you know? So sin is all over us. Who am I? Who are you? Who is he? Who is she? Nobody can save you. Only the Holy God can save us, for he is only holy. So for you is important is to accept the Messiah as your Savior, and which church you go to. I will help you later to see which one. I will see where you live. If you like to share with me some information in private, and you know, I will contact some people and see how we can help you in that field. But first, you have to accept the Messiah as your Savior, only the Messiah, no other name, you know, and that is the only way to be saved.
I think I should just do like more research into Christianity. Like I don't want to do the same mistake as last time and like believing in something that I don't know about.
What do you mean last
So
time? What last time? You called me before?
like for with Islam?
What about you called me before?
No, I said I don't want to do the
Oh,
same
yeah, like you.
mistake.
Oh, okay, you became a Muslim. I mean, you were a Muslim without knowing that Islam is bad. No
Yeah.
problem. You know, I'm not asking you to become a Christian now, but you see, for me, my friend, I have a duty, and the duty is voluntarily based in love, not because I have to again, but my duty is because I love to help you. I invite you to the best and the best of the best. That is the Messiah, because we might go to sleep right now. Either you or me, nobody knows, we might not wake up again. So for me, I would love to save Abu Hussein from hell, you know, because you might go to sleep, you never wake up. Is that correct? It might happen to
Yeah.
me, it might happen to you. Death can come in any moment. So we can be saved as long as we are alive and we believe. After that point, there's no point. That's it. So for me, I would love to see you saved today, not tomorrow. But for sure, this is a choice you make. And I don't want you to say Shahada. We don't believe in this garbage. I want you to believe from your heart, not to repeat words you do not know even what they mean. We don't want such a thing. We don't, you know, Christianity, there's no hypocrisy of saying, I say Shahada, and that's it, you are saved. Many, they lie. They say, oh, the Christian believe that Jesus saved them. That's it, they can commit sin. This is big fat lie. The Messiah said, not everyone says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of my Father, but the one who do his will, which mean believe in him, but yet you are a filthy person. You never repent. You are not a believer. A true believer is the Messiah who describe him as, from their fruits you shall know them. So how you know a Christian person? A Christian person, he spent his time speaking about Christ, bringing people to Christ, defending the truth, loving people, helping others, helping the elders, loving his parents, loving his family, taking care of the poor. That is a Christian. It's not, those things will not take you to heaven, no. But those things is the fruit of a believer. So the Messiah said, from their fruits you shall know them, which mean if you are a truly true a believer, then you do what you would believer do. Otherwise, how a believer can be a believer yet he have no good fruits? So we don't believe that because
Yeah.
I made donation I will go to heaven. No, you cannot bribe God. But we believe that because you are a believer, that belief will make you produce the good fruit, which is a fruit fit with the Holy God. So from their fruit we will know them, but it's not the fruit will save you. It's your faith. The fruit is an evidence of you being alive. It's like the blood, you know, you have a blood. How we know that this person is alive? We know we have his heart is beating. So how come he is claiming to be alive but he have no heart? So in Christianity, the second you believe in the Messiah, your heart should be there. And what does that mean? Your heart for the poor, your heart for the elder, your heart for the needy, your heart for the sick, your heart for the one who need help, your heart for your parent, to love them, to respect them, your heart for everybody around you, loving everybody. That is your heart. So you became a believer, you have hate in your heart, you are no Christian. You became a believer, you hurt others, you are no Christian. You became a believer, you want to kill, you want to hate, you want to disgrace people, you are no Christian. So from their fruit we shall know them, my friend, and that is the fruit of Jesus, not my fruit. Which mean, because I believe in Jesus the Christ, that fruit is coming automatically from me, for his light is shining through my face, through my blood, through my action, through my words. And this is why I spend my time today with you, my friend and my brother Abu Hussein. I do not know you, my friend. I never met you. I have no idea who are you. But voluntarily, for the sake of love of God, he made me sit with you all those hours. And honest to God, my eyes are hurting, my back is hurting, and I wish really I go and lay down. But because I would love to save you before I go, I said to you, I want to stay with you until tomorrow. I want to stay with you until next week. May the Lord open your heart and save you and accept the Messiah. And this is why I'm staying with you until now.
Okay, thank you so much, CP.
No, don't thank me, my friend. I'm just telling you what is making me do what I'm doing. If you want to thank the Lord, the Messiah. I just told you, he is the one who made me do that. You see, if not him, I would be busy watching an action movie, maybe, or going to nightclubs. You know what I mean? So
Yeah.
it is not me really who is doing this to you, it is him. We just said, when you are a believer, the fruit of the Messiah is going to come through you. This is not my fruit. This is his fruit. My fruit is ugly. I have nothing good. Nothing good of me. Nothing good to be proud about. It is him who gave me little wisdom to share with you, so you might became a believer and you will be saved. If you
I understand what you're saying about Christianity is like all about forgiveness, and then about like Jesus like coming to save you, and then I like the message.
There's nothing like the Messiah, my friend. It's not only a message only. You see, talk is cheap. I can speak good, but I can't do bad. The Messiah is the only person who spoke and he did what he say. You see, Jesus, he keeps saying to us, forgive, forgive, love your enemy. It's okay. What if Jesus, he did not practice what he said? That will make him hypocrite, correct? Do you know what Jesus said when they were crucifying him in the cross?
I actually don't know.
He said, forgive them, Father, they do not know what they are doing. Can you imagine, Abu? I mean, you are putting nails in my hands, humiliating me, killing me, literally. And yet, I'm worried about you. Asking the Father to forgive them, saying they do not know what they are doing. How much love is that? Can you imagine?
Yeah, like a lot of love.
So the Messiah is a person who do say something and he practice every word he said. It's going to be very embarrassing if he don't do what he asked us to do in the death, in the moment of pain. Everybody's shouting, kill him, kill him, his blood in our hands, yet he is forgiving them. How amazing that is. This is why when I say to you, the Messiah said that from their fruits you shall know them. So how we know the Messiah? From his fruits. Otherwise we do not know how he looked like. How I know the Messiah? From his fruits, my friend. His fruits is amazing. It's not just a name. It's not just a reputation. It's not just a followers. It's just not how huge a number the Christianity, how big their church is. It doesn't matter if the church is small or big. If there's one believer left in Christ, still Christ is the truth. The number is not important. Forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing. That is the teaching of God. That is the love of God. So the Lord, the Messiah, each time you were questioning about the Bible, how come in the Bible there is a contradiction? How come in the Lord himself, he is saying, forgive him, Father. He do not know what he's doing. This is how much he loves you. And that what make me, speak to you, and I am not upset for saying there is a contradiction in the Bible, there is etc. Because I know, I understand that the Lord, he taught me to be patient, forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing. And you are like my little brother. I'm sure I'm older than you. Still, age is not important. It's about how mature we are, how intelligent we are, and how right decisions we make. And today is your day, my friend. I invite you right now as we speak to accept the Messiah as your Lord, as your Savior. And it's up to you to say, yes, I accept, or to say, I don't want.
Okay, I accept. I accept.
Amen to that. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord. Glory to the Lord. I pray. I pray from my heart to our friend here, our brother, that he today, his soul, his name, his face, his hands, his fingers, his fingerprint is registered in the book of God as person who is being saved, and he is a person who believed. I pray from my heart, my friend, to you that you forgive me if I was harsh with you. I was harsh because I want to save you. I was maybe a little bit tough because I want to help you. Sometime we have to be burned by the fire so we can be healed from injury. And today you've been healed. I'm so happy for you, Abu.
Can I just I have to go right now.
My friend, don't worry. I know you are crying. I'm happy for you. Those are tears of a glory. You know, wash your heart, wash yourself, and you are a new person today. You are reborn again with Christ. So those tears, nothing to be ashamed of. You know, the real man is the one who cry when it is time to cry, and there's no shame.
I can call you back tomorrow.
All right, my friend. My brother. Sorry, not my friend no more. You are my brother. So I'm so happy for you, Abu. I'm so glad that you accept the Lord, and I will be happy to help you. Later, if you want me to help you to see, if you can share with me later, maybe. Not now, not necessarily now. So I can see, find some good Christians to help you, to take you to churches, and to learn more about the Bible and to Bible study, and then may the Lord help us and find you the right time to do baptism so you accept the Holy Spirit, and the Lord, he will be your guide forever and ever. Amen.
Okay.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you for calling.
Thank you so much, CP.
Thank you. Take care. God bless you.
Thank you.
I'm so happy for this gentleman, this brother. Sometime, you spend too much time, but it's worth it. God is good. And the one who made you leave Islam today and accept him is him, not me. Nothing is done by my hands. The Lord, he opened your heart. The Lord, he made you call me. The Lord, he helped you. And the Lord, he helped me. So thank you, Lord, for what he did today. That is one of his blessing, and his blessing is many. Today, Abu, you were a blessing to me, for I receive a blessing from the Lord to help you. And you are a blessing to your family. You are a blessing for those Christians. And I pray that all the Christians today, they will pray for this wonderful person who was at least honest, even though he's fighting hard to reject, to stay in his old belief. But then the truth will set you free. That's what the Bible says. Read the books, search for the truth, and the truth will set you free. And the Messiah said, I am the truth. I am the truth. And remember, each time the Messiah, he says, I am, he says, I am God. When Moses asked God, who are you? He said, I am Yahweh. That is what I am. People don't understand that the word I am is considered as a name for God in the Bible. But they read it as a translation. But the fact, it is, this is how God, he presented himself. So the Messiah, he said to us everywhere, I am the truth. How a prophet of God can be, I am, how he can be the truth? You are just a man. I am the light. How you can be the light? You're just a man. I am the Alpha. I am the Omega. I am the beginning. I am the end. I am the judge. I am the door. I am the resurrection. I am the life. What do you want more? And yet they say to us, where he said, I'm God, worship me. If this is not about God, worship me, this is about what? I hope today we have a good time together. And I hope that we learned that sometime we do not know how things work. You know, I thought this gentleman, he will call me, he was challenging me, he will call me names, he will insult me, he will hang up. I don't know what will happen. But look, the Lord, he's wonderful, and he brought me a beautiful soul, so we can help him, and we can all rejoice with him. He was a crying at the end, but this is a good cry. It's better than a crying in the judgment day, my friend. This is a good cry. This is the perfect cry. It's a cry of salvation. It's a cry of happiness. It's a cry, I am free. I am not a pagan kissing black stone, believing in a black stone, going around the stones. I am a follower, not of the dead Muhammad. I am a follower of the living Messiah, who is right now as we speak in heaven. And the Messiah, he said, every two of you mention my name, I will be between them. I will be the third. He is exist. He hears us. He is with us. I will never leave you alone. That is the Messiah. With this, I want to say thank you guys for being here. I'm really tired. I had a long day, and it's already getting so late for me. I wish I can stay longer. I was willing to stay longer if he like insist, but thank God, you know, he finally, the Lord, he softened his heart, and he accepted the truth, and the truth set him free. So I apologize. I wish I can stay longer. I hope tomorrow, which is today already, we will be here again. Don't forget to subscribe. And don't forget, please, I made a video before that in every Friday, Saturday, Sunday, we will be in this account, as you see in YouTube, Quality of Life M27. That is a different account. We will speak about everything, including, you know, we can discuss about things in the Bible, but not to debate about Islam. So that channel will be for good quality stuff. So don't forget to subscribe. Maybe the admin, he can post the link for it. So the Quality of Life M27, actually, just check the video before this one, two videos before this one. You will see the link and you can join us and subscribe. And remember, we will be there every Friday, Saturday and Sunday, and we will take calls from Christians, because all the week we take calls from Muslims only. So I decide to make those days to take calls from the Christians if they like to call and share. So thank you. May the Lord bless you, and have a great night, Abu. And I hope today, all of you, before you sleep, to pray for this brother, that his family, they will love him. He will love his family too. He will be good to his parents, even though they are Muslims. He will not be a harmful person to them. He will share the love of Christ with the Muslims. He will never hate the Muslims, because we are Christians. And because we are Christians, we love everybody, including the Muslims. And because we love them, we want to save them. Not because we hate them. We don't hate them. Hate is from the devil. Hate is not from God. Hate is not from Christ. Hate does not make you Christian. Hate makes you Muslims. So stay away from hate. Be aware of hate. Hate is nothing but of the devil. Have nothing to do with God. Have nothing to do with the good God. For God is good, he made me love my enemy. For God is good, he made me love everybody. For God is good, he made us love the poor, love the needy. For God is good, he made the mother love her child, sacrifice herself to him. For God is good, he made the father work all day long to feed his babies. For God is good, he provide us with shelter and food and mercy for each other. For God is good, he sent us the most beautiful gift, his only begotten Son, to save us from the hellfire. For God is good. I wish you the good day and a good life and good tomorrow. Christ is Lord. Islam is extremely false and proven every day. Take care and God bless. Bye-bye.